sounds a bit more.
Does it?
Right, hi everyone. Thanks all for coming. I presume most of you meet every couple of weeks, so this is not your week for meeting. Is that right?
The one we can only kick off.
Have you just come out to see me?
Yeah.
Not like a bit of pressure, is it? Yeah. So I don't think I've met most of you. I've met a couple of them. I know Daz and a couple of other people. So yeah, thanks for coming. Why is it always raining in Manchester? I think everyone's got webbed feet and hands around here, aren't they? It was sunny in Sheffield, weren't it? Right, so thanks a lot for coming. I'm not sure what you actually want me to talk about tonight. So what I thought is, I've had loads of experiences and stuff that we're all interested in. So rather than put a structure to everything, if anyone caught you, just give us a shout. Rather than put a structure, I'll talk about this, that and other, I've just got to a skeleton sort of thing, and if you want to ask anything or any experiences you've had yourself, just give us a shout. I know a lot of us are interested in saying things, council types, and so what I'm going to focus on tonight is sort of, I don't pay for anything apart from the mortgage. I have to pay for that because I've told this story a few times, but you may not be aware. I had to back down last Christmas. I nearly got kicked out 9 days before Christmas, so I'm working on that, and I think I'm about 98% sure I've got a plan that we can, if you have got a mortgage, we can claim it back. Claim our house back. We aren't having to pay anymore either. But that, I'm shelving that for a moment. I think I'm going to do a future talk on that, perhaps within a month or so. So things I've concentrated on are really what are important to us in terms of value. Your house, your vehicle, what them lot were oppressing us. Them lot are oppressing us, what they perceive as valuable, then it's most hard-hitting for us, isn't it? And I'm not saying your children are possessions, but your children are the most important thing in the world, or they should be, or they are to me. Then your house, then your vehicle, and then it's things like council tax and stuff. So what happened to me is, about 5 years ago, I ended up skint. I had to pack my work in to look after my children, and I got no money coming in. So I already was studying things for probably since I was a little kid, really, weren't we? We knew lots of things, we knew how things worked. But what I didn't understand is the law and money. You've got to understand what money is, what it actually is. So about 5 years ago, I had to pack work in and become a single parent. Thus, no money coming in. So I thought, what am I going to do? And that's when I started studying what the law is and what actual money is. And what I found out is, for me, it's the final nail in the coffin for them. Although I knew how everything worked, that corporations had took over and these things like satanic entities and Vatican, I knew all that, but I couldn't do a lot about it. And just by whether it's pure chance or somebody's leading me this way, the law and money side gave me a tool to fight back. It were a choice, feed my children or pay the corporations. Well, it's a no-brainer, isn't it? So when I started studying this money aspect and law aspect, information quickly came to me, I don't know how, and it came in the right order. So what I did is I started fighting back, hence my name Rob Freeman. I used the early Freeman principles, and sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. Anyway, after 2 or 3 years, I started realising, I know a lot of lads go down the legal, lads, a lot of people go down the legal route. The whole thing about this legal system is you cannot win. I've studied thousands of statutes, acts of Parliament. It starts off one bit, you get all the way through it, and it's contrary to everything it previously said. It's designed that way to keep us in conflict, to keep us in confusion, so we don't understand it, basically. We're not meant to understand it. I don't even think they understand it. So what I realised is, I'm not going to fight them anymore. I'm not going down any legal route. What I decided is, I'm going to live. How can I say it? Not illegal, but unlegal. And that's what I class myself as, unlegal, but always lawful. I presume most of you know, but if you don't, I'll go through the difference. So through necessity, I decided I'm going to be as unlegal as possible, but not illegal. There is a difference. So based on all that, this is where and how I've arrived at where I am now. Like I say, I don't pay for anything. I'm trying to think desperately of a bill that I pay. Apart from I stick a bit of diesel in my car and I feed my kids. And then there's that mortgage, which I almost got there but I had to back down. I don't pay for anything. And as it's evolved this last, I would say, 12 months, I've never been taken to court for any demand for money ever. It never gets that far. And I don't know if a lot of you are doing it or having a go at things. And everyone's got a different way of doing stuff. But what I've realised is that don't try and fight their system, the legal stuff. I sort of sideswipe the legal system now. I don't bother with it. They don't bother with our stuff, so I don't bother with theirs. And what I realise is I don't fight them anymore. I don't try and learn their legal stuff. That's like it takes 10 years to be a barrister. I ain't got that sort of time. So what I realised is they've got a system in place. It's all for them and not for us. So, hang on a minute, I'm not fighting them anymore. I'll mirror back everything they do. They can't say it's not working because they're using it on us daily. So all I do is mirror it back. And so far, I have nobody dare come to my house. No, even me, I've got an outside post box and postman goes like that and runs, it's on a gate. So nobody even approaches my house. I've got two mates and my brother and that's it, nobody else comes. And it's not that I'm particularly clever, I don't think I am. If anything, I've got a little bit of bottle on. I won't be told what to do. And as you know, I don't cause anybody on this planet harm if I can help it, any living soul. So in my eyes, and in God's eyes or creator or whoever, I've not committed a crime. So anything else short of that, why are we being punished, or what offence, you know, have we committed? Who have we offended? What are we doing wrong? If we don't cause harm, you can say harm or loss, or don't be fraudulent in your contracts. It's all the same thing. It all comes under one thing. Three words for Lord: do no harm. That's it. End of story. You don't do any harm to another living soul. You've never committed a crime, so you're not accountable to anyone. So that's a kind of brief overview. Also, I want to mention Critical Mass Radio. Alex and myself are both hosts on it. Have most of you heard the station? Have you tuned into the station? Critical Mass Radio, anybody? Anybody? Yeah. That was on Alex's show. Yeah. Yeah, if you've not got onto it.
I'd say you've gutted me, you really did.
Yeah, if you've not heard it, get onto criticalmassradio.co.uk and there's, I don't know how many shows a week is there, Paul? There's quite a lot, isn't there?
Yeah, we've got 15, 16 shows a week now.
Yeah, and they're all coming from a slightly different angle, but all the hosts work really hard, and however hard we work, he works three times as hard. But it's all against solutions, and this is what I'm here for tonight. I've found solutions. I'm not saying they're perfect, and I'm not saying I'm super intelligent, but they're working for me. And if I can shed a bit of light, you might come away tonight with one thing that might help you, and you might think, oh, I never thought of that. So that's what I'm here for tonight, and don't believe anything I say, and I don't want you to go out and do it. But what I saw, we had a meeting about 3 or 4 weeks ago. I did a talk there in, what's the place called? Vine Dynamics, isn't it? And I saw in people's eyes there a little bit of confidence. I've been to loads of talks, and I've listened to speakers, and I've only seen a bit of fear in people, well, what can we do? And the last talk I did, and these people that came, I saw a little bit of fire, and they thought, yeah, I'm going to have a go at something small. It could be a parking ticket, or not paying your TV licence, it could be any of that. Something small, but I think now, daily, we should all now be having a go at something. And it's not just about non-payment, it can be anything. You can write a letter to your bloody MP and say, what's this shit in the sky, what are these trails? Can you please explain what they are? Or my teenage kids look at pop and rock videos. What are all these messages? Just ask them. We should all be doing something. And we know it's a wide variety of things. It's not just the law and money. It's all sorts, isn't it? But we should all be doing something. And I do it daily. I every time I go into my town, I park in the magistrate's car park. Magistrates in my town hate me. Well, I've got to go back next week as well. So I always park in their car park. I've had 104 parking tickets in 3 years. A bit disappointed, I wanted to get it a bit higher, but I've never paid for one. And no one's ever come to my house, no one's even bothered me. Now you can say, well, you're taking piss, and I suppose I am really. But I do it because I want to push out, see out where boundaries are, push it as far as it can go. If somebody's putting a financial demand on you for 30 quid, it doesn't matter whether you've got another six zeros after that, or it's 30,000, it doesn't matter. The process is exactly the same, and this is what I want to talk about tonight. Yeah? So, a lot of people think, oh, it's him, he never wants to pay out. And they're right, I don't want to pay out. I haven't got much money coming in, so I'm going to pay as little as possible. But the concept of what money is, if you understand what money is, and this to me opened everything for me, and that unless you were born before 1929, I'd say perhaps 1920, so you're old enough to go to shops or whatever, none of us have ever paid for anything in our lives. You, me, none of us. It's the illusion that we've paid for it. We've never paid for it. The United Kingdom, it's a duality, it's a geographical landmass, United Kingdom, the country itself, which is rich. We've got resources, we've got greenery, water, it's a beautiful country. Alongside that, two tiers, the United Kingdom Corporation. That's the thing that's bankrupt. It's been bankrupt, I think, since it's either 1931 or 1933, I always get mixed up, America's same. But what that means is we are operating, the United Kingdom Corporation right now is operating in what's called the equivalent of a Chapter 22 bankruptcy. It means debtors in possession. And what that means is every pound note, I call them pound notes because I'm old fashioned, every pound note that you think you're paying for something, nothing ever gets paid for, it's a promise to pay. See, Don, they're nodding there. It's a promise to pay that never ever gets fulfilled. So all your drinks tonight, your petrol you put in your car, and these crappy clothes I'm wearing, we've never paid for anything. So I want to get onto that a little bit later. And so is it me getting away with not paying for anything? Or is it me realising that we don't pay for anything anyway? So am I doing anything wrong? So that's where I want to start. I'll tell you what I'll do. I've not got much of a structure on this. If anyone wants to ask any questions even now, just give us a big shout, right? Right, so how I've arrived here at this particular time. Let's have a look. Problem I've got is I've got that much information, I'm going to try and condense it all. That's the
got any problems with it,
or I'll just waffle on you.
If we never pay for anything, why are we paying tax?
Well, we're not actually paying tax, are we? Because we're not paying for anything. It's an illusion.
The throws in prison if we don't pay.
Okay, that's a good one. All right, do you want to start off with tax? I'll tell you what limited knowledge I've got on tax. Okay, am I in shot here?
Yeah.
Okay, if you can still hear me, because I've got my back turned. I presume you mean income tax, yeah?
Yeah.
So you're employed?
Sort of.
Okay. Rob Freeman, got into the early Freeman stuff, realised that every demand on you, every demand for money or whatever, is a contract. So it's contract law. Well. I don't think I've ever paid income tax. I think I paid 6 months out of my life, and I'm in my late 40s now. So I just dodged it anyway in the past, because I'm a little bollocks. But now I really do know it's rubbish. Okay, so early Freeman stuff, just as income tax if you can't see it. So I had a look what income were. I've got about 15 or 16 law dictionaries. I know it's legal stuff, but I like to know what, you know, they use legalese. It's a different language, isn't it? The language of the law. So I thought, well, I'll learn a bit of legalese. And it's quite addictive, really, because although I don't get out legal route anymore, I did it the first couple of years I were doing this. This is from 5 years up to present day. So the first couple of years, I looked at legal stuff and I thought, oh, it's interesting, we might be able to beat them on a statute or an act. And then I realised, after a couple of years, there's no chance. But I still read their legal dictionaries, their definitions. And so I thought, well, what's income tax? Have a look. The original definition of income was profit or gain from corporate activity. Corporate. So it's a corporation. So you've been taxed, that's the definition of income. Profit or gain from corporate activity. So I thought, that's interesting. So a man, why is he paying income tax when it only applies to corporate activity? They've changed definition now. Now it's called wages. Is it wages on, income from employment, as wages it's called now. So I'll start looking at it. Income tax is only for corporations. So that's where the way they get around that is the legal fiction name, as I presume most of you know about that. So they've corporatised us, haven't they? So for instance, I'm Mr. Rob Freeman. So the way they get around things is income tax applies to, I'm a corporation of one. So that's why they can do it. So I studied the law of contracts, law of contracts. That doesn't apply to a man, a human being, a woman, a human being. It only applies to your corporate fiction name. That's why your tax demands will come in that either all capitals, long tits, or Mr. So-and-so, which is another legal title. So there's a way you can stop paying it, but the problem we've got is we can't do it on our own. We need employers. employers, it's the use of that national insurance number, that NI number. Every job you get, you have a national insurance number, don't you? That national insurance number means that you're working for the government, you're a government employee, a government agent. Therefore, you are taxable, because you're classed as a corporate entity working for the government. I know it's all confusing, but that's what they see in their minds. So what we need is, we need employers who might have a small workforce, is to stop using this. This, I don't know if I'm still in shock, this all capital name. I spoke about it last time on that last talk. I used to be shit scared of it. Don't want to go near it, or it might have that. Don't go near it, I'm frightened to death. That's on this side.
Oh, you're right,
I'm right there. You have a pirouette then. I used to be terrified of that name. I've been in court many, many times. I've been arrested loads of times. I'm not Mr. Rob Freeman. I'm Rob of the Freeman family. They look at me, and there's no wonder I didn't get very far, because I made myself look a bit of a twerp, really. Some part of me, some part of everybody, some part of me is in that. That's not the whole me, but that's a facility, a tool that's created to engage in commerce. I do engage in commerce at some point. Some part of me is in that, but that's not. So look at it differently. That is a corporate entity, and it is taxable, and it is classed as a corporation because of this. So if we can get an employer or employers to employ staff by not using that, what you'd have to do is a private contract. For instance, if I want to work for you, right? We have a private contract between us, and it's man to man. A human being and a human being can contract. A human being and a corporation cannot contract. The reason being is, if me and you want to enter a working contract, it's a meeting of the minds, and we both sign it. It starts off as an agreement, and we sign a contract. Two signatures, equal amount of value, equal amount of risk, equal amount of, we've got full disclosure, we agree our terms, we both sign it. If I work for you, on a private contract, it's non-taxable. We negate this, we have nothing to do with this. Why is it non-taxable? Why should it be non-taxable? If you said to me, paint my house, I'll give you 500 quid. I've put 40 hours of my energy and time into that for a fair swap for what I perceive to be 500 quid. How can it possibly be taxable? How can it be right to be taxable? It can't, can it? Why then am I giving up my 40 hours to work and get my reward for working, and then have to pass it on to government or anybody? It's theft, isn't it? And they get away with it because of this. We agree by using this. That needs to go. So I don't know if that makes any sense, but that's what we need. We need employers to employ people through private contracts. That's just one of many taxes, isn't it? Is that a bit clearer or anything? Now, no short-term solution there, is there? But let's, okay.
Can we apply this if we're self-employed? Give it up.
It's better if you're self-employed, isn't it? If you're self-employed, you're working for yourself, aren't you? It becomes a private contract. You are a contractor. You're contracting yourself out, aren't you? Mm-hmm. If you're a self-employed mechanic and you fix my car, people say, you have to declare it. Ooh, excuse me. What are you declaring? You don't have to declare anything. You're, for instance, a mechanic, self-employed. You come and fix my car. I've only 400 quid. What are we declaring to and what? Why? You've put so much amount of work. We've agreed our payment terms. It doesn't have to be a written down contract. It can be a verbal contract. You fix my car. I've only 400 quid. What's it got to do with anything else? Nobody, government or nobody, can stick their noses in our private business when it's man to man. Yeah? It's not Mr. Freeman with, I don't know my name, but Mr. Smith. It's Robin, Dave, or Paul, or whoever. Whoever it is, it's our private contract. So if you want to be self-employed, it's even easier. It's the employers that we need to come forward and start listening, because they feel like they have to use this, which is then taxable. Okay. I don't think that's going to be a short-term remedy. That's going to take quite a long time. I think everybody should be self-employed.
Yeah, but the tax man is trying to bully such people, isn't it?
The tax man?
Yeah, they're trying to tell them, oh, no, you can't do that. Because
This happens with the ladies when they know how to cut hair, and you know, they visit families to cut hair and everything. And I've met a few.
Like a mobile.
Yeah, like mobile. And this would be exactly personal lady, blah, 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 came to me to cut my hair. And I gave them like 20 quid or something. But they are absolutely terrified. They're trying to do it on the, the carpet, as they call it. But they're terrified because they think that they have, and I understand that somebody even paid a huge fine because they didn't do it, they didn't try not to pay.
Yeah, well, as we know, the whole system's based on fear, isn't it? This is what I was saying earlier. I've got a bit of bottle, not because I'm clever or anything, but I've got no fear. Because the only reason I've got no fear is I'm not doing anything wrong. Why would you have any fear? The only fear that we've got is what they're telling us that we should have. Again, it's not going to spread out to the masses, but we need to start doing things, or at least looking into it. What I want to do is see smaller communities, like a mechanic, an hairdresser or whatever, working with each other on private contracts. And it's nothing to do with those people. It's nothing to do with these. These people that are supposed to be working for us are just dreaming up every idea to take every extract, everything off us, aren't they?
They do say you have to file a tax return. You have to.
Does it say you have to? Or you, does it say you must or you have to?
Must.
Who said that? Must.
Must, I'm
sure. Yeah, well, get some law dictionaries, get back to law dictionaries, learn legalese, we know what must means.
Must isn't in there, what the dictionaries are.
Yeah, they've changed it now, haven't they? It's not now, it is in the older ones, because I've got them dating back for years. But how can you redefine a word? They redefine them every 2 years. Sorry?
My fine's over £1,200.
Okay, well, must was synonymous with may, wasn't it? Okay, well, as we knew before, they've stopped putting it in books now. I don't even think they put it in. I think you're right. But must means in legalese, the language of the law, it means may. So I got a summons a couple of years ago for stupid council tax. The summons were an invitation. The summons said, you must attend a hearing. Well, I knew legalese because I'm fluent in it. And what it really said is, instead of here's a summons, you must attend, what it was really saying is, this is an invitation, you may attend. Pardon?
Voluntary servitude.
Yeah, it's voluntary. Voluntary servitude.
But the summons I received goes on to say, if you do not attend, we may rule against you.
Okay, well, let me rule against
you. Come along if you want, but if you don't, we'll find you guilty and we'll...
Well, that's your option, isn't it? Your option is to not turn up and rule it in your absence against you, or to turn up and be treated like a slave, isn't it? That's your options, isn't it? Or pay it up straight away. But what I'm trying to say to you is... Who can tell you what to do in life? If you're not causing harm, who can tell you what to do?
Your mum.
Who? Never a true word said to your mum. You've seen our mum, haven't you? You wouldn't mess about with our mum, would you? Right, so...
Do you know of anybody who's tried to send that national insurance number back?
No. Oh, right, I didn't make myself clear. Don't send it back. Don't send it back, because... I'm no longer scared of it. It's a facility, it's a tool for us to use. You can dip in and out of that whenever you want to. Obviously, if it's full-time employment, you're using it all the time, you're gonna have to pay tax. But what I'm saying about private contracts, you can't then go and take the benefits that everything they send you. You've got to draw a line somewhere. We've got to be honourable, haven't we? So sometimes you're gonna need your national insurance for, I don't know, you might want to go away and have a passport. It's hard without a passport, isn't it? So sometimes you can decide to be a government agent when you want to, because you've got the facility to do it. You don't have to do it, you do it when you want.
So you've got to make it plain to them that when you're not working for them, you're not paying tax.
Yes, but we should all be not working for them in our 40-hour week. We shouldn't be working for them at all.
Well, like you say, if you want a passport and you use that number for your passport or your birth certificate, then you are, in effect, using that system.
Only when you're using that facility of that passport.
Yeah, you have to pay for the passport.
Yeah.
But other than that, I don't want to use it, so I'm not paying tax.
Exactly.
What you're saying is you've got to dip into it as and when. You might want to go and work for the government. You might.
I understand that.
You can use your national insurance to do that, but when you don't want to work for the government.
Do they understand it? That's what I'm trying to say.
Well, this is what I'm coming to now. Inform them. All it is a notice. Letters can be ignored, notices can't. You see a notice on a wall, you notice it straight away, don't you? Somebody puts a notice on your house. We're coming next week to empty your house. You notice it, don't you? Notice is very important. So it fits in with what we're coming on to next. Is this all making sense, by the way?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. A long journey, that, wasn't it? I don't know if I'm talking rubbish. Yeah, right, so this all fits in with what I'm doing. So anyone puts a demand on you, tax demand, financial demand, any sort of demand, anybody. I don't care if it's government, Queen Elizabeth, anybody. This is what I do. Put a demand on me, I don't cause harm to anyone. Put a demand on me, no problem. What, I don't fight them anymore now. I accept absolutely everything that they throw at me. Big tax bill, loan repayments, you name it. They throw it all my way, I don't care. I don't fight it anymore now. I don't argue. As soon as you argue, you cause conflict, it goes to court. This is what they want us to do. They want us to ignore it, not pay it. Pay some of it, not all of it, again causing conflict, or argue back, straight to court. As I've said before, magistrates' court, 97% of the time, they side with the corporations because they're all in it together. They all shoot in the same pot, don't they? So, don't cause conflict. How do we stay out of conflict and still fight back? Easy. Took me about 3 years to figure this out. Accept everything they send at you. Sounds bollocks, doesn't it? Anybody says to me, you owe me 500 quid, you borrowed, I think, borrowed 7.5 grand, I think it was. Paid some of it, got into all this, it rose to 10 grand. They had it secured on my house. I got rid of it in 2 weeks, never paid my penny again. Also, the only thing I've not done is mortgage on, I'm working on that. Everything, every single demand to pay or perform a task. Now that can come in the form of a judge's order. So anybody puts a demand on you, accept it. Don't argue, no problem. So let's say somebody says to me, you owe me £5,000, no problem. Okay, no argument, I'll accept it. However, I'll accept it just on condition there are a couple of things. Now you're accepting it, but you're asking for something in return. It's like an equal value. I owe £5,000, no problem, I may owe you that. Okay, let's say it's a loan, because I've had a few of them. Okay, every loan's fraudulent, as we know, we can go through that later on, I suppose. Somebody's demanding £5,000, I owe them £5,000. I accept it, no problem. Yeah, I may owe that, no problem, no conflict here. Can you just send me three? I need two or three things off you now. If you send them me, I'll pay it up. Okay, what I'd like is, if I owe you £5,000, we obviously had a contract somewhere along the line. Do us a favour, just send us a contract that we both signed. No problem, that's first thing. Send us a contract. Well, every loan, credit card or whatever is never a contract. They call it a contract. If you look, it's an agreement. It's only us signing. For a contract to be valid, it has to have two signatures, both people signing it, a meeting of the minds. It's not, it's an agreement. An agreement, if I agree to meet Robbie Pub tomorrow and I don't turn up, he's not going to take me to court, is he? It's just an agreement. You can break an agreement. It's bollocks. It's already signed by one person. If we sign a contract to do something and I break those terms, then he can take me to court. Because I'm acting in dishonour. You can't act dishonorably from an agreement, can you? People disagree every day, don't they? But I would be in dishonour, Rob. And if he is suffering in any way through my dishonour, then he can take me to court. So, send us a contract. They've never got one. They've never had one in the first place, so it falls down straight away. Remember, it's a loan. Number two. Let's say it's a credit card or a loan or a mortgage even, what do you get? You get a statement, don't you? You don't get, you sometimes call it an invoice, but it's a statement, isn't it? When do you ever get a bill? You've never been sent a bill, ever, none of us have. Okay, why have we not been sent a bill? Because whoever's putting that demand on you, sending that bill, has to put a live signature on it for it to be a proper bill. Like I said, were you, I don't know, say I paint your house, I say, oh, 500 quid, and you say, oh, send us a bill. And I send you a photocopied thing with a squiggle or no live signature, you'll say, no, you've not sent me a bill, that could have come from it. Somebody could have knocked it up on the computer, couldn't they? So if I'm going to, I'll sign it, won't I? And say, that's for work done, you owe me 500 quid, that's a valid bill. So, second thing we ask for, let me see if I can simplify it, contract. Yeah. Verification of the claim against me. You're claiming I owe you £5,000. Do us a favour, just send us a bill. That's all you're asking for. Piece of paper, it's valid in law. You're not doing anything wrong. Send us a copy of the contracts we both signed. send us a proper bill with a live signature on it. All important. They won't put their signature on because, and we're going into signatures if you've got time tonight, whoever signs, puts ink on paper, is instantly liable, is assuming liability. They work for limited liability corporations. What that means is we forever palming liability off, nobody wants to be liable. Yet we stand there, me, I'm going to go to court next week, I'm stood there under full commercial liability, I'm not hiding. It's like being naked in front of the law, I'm stood there. And I'm taking them on, I'm saying, this is me in full commercial liability. I'm not telling any lies, I'm stood here. They won't, they push it on. If you deal with a company, next time you get a letter, it'll be somebody else's name. And then it'll be somebody else's name, because they forever, that's the game. Palm liability off between them, shove all the liability onto us. Get us to sign everything, we're assuming liability. So, send us a bill. Send us a proper bill with a life signature, no problem. And that's it. And then I'll say, I'll tell you what, last thing, do us a favour. You're saying, I borrowed £5,000 off you. I borrowed, yeah. You lent me £5,000. Do us a favour. Just show us a copy of your accounting, which is valid in law, that shows £5,000 transferred from your account to mine. Okay? So, account. I'll call it accounting. Copy of the accounting. So that's all you ask for, those three things. Sounds complicated, don't it? But it's not. Somebody's putting a financial demand, say they'd like £5,000, send us a contract, sign a bill, send us a bill, then I know who to send it to. Live signature, so it's not fraudulent. Just show us proof of accounting that I've already offered you. Okay, they can't put, out of the 60 or maybe, I don't know, 60 or 70 times I've done it, not only have these people never come up with all these three things, they've never come up with one, because the whole thing's fraudulent. Okay, so, that's the basis of what I do for everything. You say I owe you something, it can be anything, it can be council tax, it can be TV licence, any demand you can think of, no problem, I'll pay it, do us a favour, just prove that I'm liable. Just prove that I'm liable and I'll pay the whole thing. Now there's no conflict. They can't then run along to court and say, oh, we're taking him to court because we need it adjudicated on because he said, prove that I'm liable. Well, I'm not saying anything wrong, have I? If you want me money, just prove I owe it. You could say to me, you owe me £3,000, and you could be just making it up, couldn't you? If you can't prove I owe you £3,000, I'm not going to pay you, am I? Especially if I say, well, just prove that I owe it. In what way do I owe it? You know what I mean? How am I liable to pay you that? You'd have to prove it, wouldn't you? Well, they're no different. It can be council tax, it can be anybody. You've still got to prove it that you owe it. So, that's not the whole thing. Basically, if it's not a loan, right, then you can get rid of this bottom one, because there won't be a copy of the accounting, would there? If it's council tax, if it's, I don't know, anything other than a loan, you ask for these two things. Contract law. It's a corporation. A corporation, they've got no jurisdiction whether they are county court, government agency, whoever they are. All they can do is extend the offer of the contract. That's all they can do.
Not produced a council tax bill.
It's not a bill, is it? Who signs it?
There's no contract.
There's no contract, is there? How can I bill you? I start looking at contracts in a different way. How can I put a financial demand on you, even man to man, if we've never ever had any business dealings with each other? If I can't prove we've ever ever had any business dealings between us, how can I stick a bill in for £600 off you? I can't, can I? So like, how come they can? Well, they can't.
You see the gas though, don't they? Just have to have proof of usage rather than the contract.
Who's that gas?
Yeah.
Well, that's a different story. I didn't want to. It's always one, isn't it? I pay gas and electric, I don't pay water either, but I've suffered for it a little bit. When you've got something that they can take away and cut off, you have to be a bit. I've suffered a little bit with that, but I've managed it. It's the same process, but their equipment is in your property, which give them rights. I'll let you have a fag break in five. I'm going to cover a little bit more about trust, because everything comes back to trust as well as contracts. Before there's any contract, there has to be a trust relationship. I lost, really hard to explain, I lost with the gas people, but by losing, I won. Sounds crazy, doesn't it? They were begging me to have a prepayment. I want to get my bill. I got my bill up to £3,250. I was a bit disappointed. I wanted to get it to about £3,500 to push it out. Anyway, went to court a couple of times, no problem. Tried the Freeman route, and I tried accepting for value bills, and I tried all sorts. I kept delaying it. I don't think I paid out for 2 years. I also like Amazon rainforest, so kids, my kids were like that. Even dog had sunglasses on. I was putting it, kids kept saying, "Dad, turn, what are you eating off, for God's sake?" No, no, we're all right. Anyway, I took piss, I did a bit of a last gas thing. They kept begging me to have a prepaid meter, which I wouldn't do. So we get to court, and I'll talk about a bit about trust relationship. So I went into court, and I was a bit guns blazing that day, and I am adult magistrates and judges and all those bollocks, and I told them I'm the executor of my trust and all that, and I quashed it all and said dismiss it all, blah blah blah. I gave them an official offer. If you give someone an official offer, I'll cover this in a bit. What was my official offer? I think it was £5 every 3 months. I was pushing the boat out real. But it was my official offer, which they should have accepted, because that's all I could afford at the time. Anyway, cut long story short, I blazed into court and did the trust relationship, which I'll explain again in a bit. It was on that other talk. And as I was walking out, I said to the magistrates, the three magistrates, the one in the middle is always the head magistrate. I said, what they wanted to do is to come in and either fit me a meter. Luckily, my meter was too close to the floor, so they couldn't fit me one. So that were a problem, because I got my mate to check in. So the only thing they could do is make me pay or disconnect me. I wanted to be disconnected. I can tell you that why later. So I rushed into court. Sorry, it's a bit up and down this. Rushed into court, did the trust thing, hammered them all. As I'm going to the door, I said to the magistrates, if any of you sign an order now to have me disconnected, I want a live signature. Now, I've never seen this, I don't know if any of you have. The woman magistrate gets up and puts pen to paper. I thought, fucking hell, I've never ever, she's assuming liability. I thought, I've never ever seen, anybody had anything from a magistrate or a county court, it's always a photocopy. You can't even recognise name, can you? She stands up in front of, I took seven witnesses with me, and puts a live signature on an order. I'll tell you what an order is in a bit, and it's even more mind-blowing. I thought, WTF. Anyway, I go out with my mates to a cafe. Hello, come in. I go with my mates to a cafe, and I get a strange feeling in my tummy. I'm just sitting down to a coffee. I said to my mates, I need to get home. Rushed home, there's seven gas vans, two police cars up road, and two very strange blokes in suits walking about like barristers. I thought, what's going on for you? All for me. And what I realised is, I'd used a trust relationship many times, I used it again, and I lost. And the reason I lost is, they came in, by the way, and he were on his hands and knees, please pay. Right now, okay, disconnect me, take your meter out. Now, bear in mind, I've got their property. The reason I won and lost is, she stood up and signed it, that magistrate, because I've got their equipment, so I'm trustee. I'm acting as trustee. I didn't realise at the time, I'm acting as trustee for their equipment. So in actual fact, I'm in breach of trust, because the whole thing were not to get me cut off, were to get their equipment back. And a side effect of them taking their gas meter back, for safety reasons, is to disconnect the gas, isn't it? So the whole thing's a scam. Where to disconnect me were to get their equipment back. So the reason I lost is, and she stood up and signed it, is the trust thing, it proved to me that it works even more. Because I'm entrusted with their equipment. Now I'm not looking after it. I can't stop them having my own trust can't nick their equipment off them. They want it back, don't they? So in effect, I was in breach of trust. That's why she stood up. That's why she put pen to paper. Because they're doing nothing wrong. They need their equipment back.
You told her to do it.
Yeah, you are beneficiary. You ordered it because you're beneficiary.
I'm a trustee, which is worse position. They've entrusted their equipment to me. I'm entrusted. I'm the trustee.
Yeah, you said earlier that you went in. You said that you were the beneficiary.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
But you did say it, so obviously if you've ordered them, because obviously the beneficiary, you put the order in. So when you ordered them, she took your order.
Yeah, you're right. I went in and I said, I'm the general executor, which calls the shots, and the beneficiary of the Rob Freeman Trust. Your judges, magistrates, your public servants, your trustees. That's right. But their trust, the gas people, I'm not the general executor of their trust, I'm the trustee. So they acted not on my trust, where it's gone, they acted on their trust. Now, as a customer, I'm their trustee. So really, I'm in the wrong. What I should have done If it had not been a gas meter, if it had been a DVD player, I could have stuck it outside and said, come and collect your equipment. But because it was gas, there's a safety aspect, they have to turn it off. So whenever you get disconnected from electric and gas, you're not getting disconnected, especially gas, you're not getting disconnected, they want their equipment back. So that the trust thing worked against me, which is why she stood up, but it didn't really work against me, it worked for me.
So when you put your own meter on,
okay,
are you breaking the lock?
That's a good point. I've got a lot of friends who are wild. Okay, what we did is we realised that whenever you're getting billed for gas and electric or water, utilities, they are supplying nothing. Mine were Western Power, stupid, whatever they were. They supply me. I've got their meter in my house. I didn't want to do gas and electric, but we're on it now, aren't we? So, 5 minutes and we'll have a break. Western Power, stick a meter in my property, or when I bought it, it were already in there. They say they supply me for gas. Load of bollocks. They're not. What they're doing is, they're charging me for the privilege of it passing through their meter.
Yeah.
Whoa, they're not supplying me with anything, are they, Dad? Same, I have electric with the same people, so I thought, hang on a minute. Same with water people. You might not have a meter, but somewhere along your pipeway you have got a meter. In fact, I think my mate, his job is to look at them. There's a water meter somewhere counting on your usage. But hang on a minute, these companies are not supplying. They're charging you for the privilege of it passing through their meter. I thought, well, who's supplying them? And what I found out is that your gas and electric come from Transco, I think it's National Grid. You don't just supply, your house supplies the whole street. So what I thought is, hang on a minute, why am I paying Western Power the line saying, their meter's clocking up, right? I don't know what usage, and they don't know, that's why it's always estimated, they haven't got a clue what you're using. They can't differentiate from number 26 to number 28 houses. They haven't got a clue, they just stick anything on it. But hang on, they're charging me for supply. Where's contract? There's no contract again. So what I did is, I got cut off the gas on purpose, and the same company were electric. So what I did is, I notified them, I said, look, this is how I see it. You've got 14 days to come and get your, 10 days I think, to come and get your meter back. I don't want your meter in my property, so come and get it. If you don't get it after 14 days, I'm going to charge you £100 a day, storage charge. So they come and took the meter back. But what I found out is that Transco, the way these energy companies make the money is Transco contract it out to them. So through legislation, they're allowed to put their meters in. So going back to that original question, you can buy a meter as long as it's checked, so British Standard Gas or Safety meter, you can buy yourself less than £100. So I think someone got one for a tenner electric meter. Okay, so what my friends have done, I don't do it. What my friends have done is bought meters, made sure they're British Standard, got a qualified person to install them, signed off that it's safe, sent a letter, like Daz quite rightly said, to the Energy Minister saying that we've now installed our own meters, zeroed them. And every 3 months, they send a quarterly figure for gas and electric to the direct suppliers of Transco National Grid. My mate's been doing it for 18 months, which is, he should have had 6 bills now, and he's paid a grand total of nothing.
Oh, that's good.
The reason they can't bill him is because they blanket out the energy, and the power companies pay for the contract, and all they do is stick a figure on a meter. Well, it can mean anything. So Transco National Grid won't bill him because they don't know how much he's using. All they know is how much is coming to that street. 7,000 units to Transco means nothing. They don't know what it is. They're not bothered. They make millions from contracting out. So he never gets a bill. Technically, I don't think he's got a contract with them, has he? There's not a contract. There's an implied contract. There's no contract in place. So he's worse than me. He has free electric and gas. Keep sending up meter readings. Notified Energy Minister of what he's done. Can anybody see what he's doing wrong? Because I can't.
No.
I can't. If anybody can see what he's doing wrong, I can't see a thing. But anyway, he's had no bill for 18 months now. Dad's.
Isn't there something with being shipperless as well?
Oh, brilliant, yeah. Do you know what? I don't know anybody else who's come up with this. I found this out. What I found out is that when I got cut off the gas, I got cut off on purpose because my whole plan was, and what I found out is from a gas insider, he used to work for big gas companies, three and a half grand bill, whatever it is, they tell you can never get set up with another energy company, can you, until you pay your bill? You've got it all done in it together, aren't they? I found out from a former big gas engineer, used to work for him, hates him now, said, listen, let them cut you off for 3 months. After 3 months, you're classed, nice one to ask for this, you're classed as what's called shipperless. I thought, shipperless. Black's Law Dictionary. I couldn't find shipperless, but I found shipper. Shipper was one who contracts out, one who contracts out to supply something belonging to somebody else. So basically...
Carrier, wasn't it?
Did you remember what it was?
It was something to do with the carrier. Shipper is a carrier.
The energy was being shippered, weren't it, by the energy company for Transco. After 3 months, you are classed as shipperless, which means you can then set up again with a new gas company. They can still chase you for that money, it doesn't matter, you can ignore it, and you can't be refused. But obviously you can't do it for electric, can you? So, yeah, you're classed as shipperless, and that works for anything.
It's the same with electric and shipperless.
But you're going to get cut off for 3 months, aren't you? That's the problem. This is what I'm saying, guys. You can't go out electric for 3 months, can you? You can quite easily do it in summer. I made sure it were July, August, September, for the gas. But I got it sold before that anyway.
The way I looked at it, it was cheaper to go and rent another place for 3 months and then move back and have free electric for the rest of your life.
There's always a way. Do you want to have a break and have a drink and a
fag?
Are you all refreshed? Still got a glass, yeah?
Yeah,
I've not got as much cover as I want over here, so going back to this stuff, I haven't finished it off yet. I've not showed you how I finish it off. Can everybody see that board? It doesn't say much like, but... So that was a long, weren't it? Three things I asked for. So any demand, I know we got sidetracked with gas and electric and stuff, but don't worry about it. Any demand anyone's placing on here, accept it, or just show me a bit of proof, and then I'll do whatever you want to, but they never do, they never can. So, remember I said I asked for a contract, never one in place. Give me a bill, never send a bill. If it's a loan, or a credit card, which is a loan, or a mortgage, we'll leave them alone for now. Show me a copy of your accounting. So, you don't just ask for that, well you can just ask for that, but it'll go on forever. We need to bring some sort of conclusion to it. So, send off a simple notice asking for those three things. I give them a time limit, I give them 14 days. Can you please send me this within 14 days? If you don't put a time limit on it, it can drag on for years, can't it? You're doing nothing wrong. Here's a notice, send me those three things, or two things if it's not a loan. Here's 14 days, I'll wait for your answer. 14 days goes by, they either ignore you, or they send something that's irrelevant to what you're asking for. So now you've got them. Okay, send second notice number two, or letter number two goes out. Me again, I realise that you're very busy people working for a corporation. You might have big, fat, lazy staff. My notice might be sat on your desk. Tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you another 10 days. I realise you're busy. I'll give you a second 10 days to give me this. I'm a very busy man myself. I'm going to give you a second 10 days. Nothing, you do nothing wrong. Come up with these documents, please. Okay. If you don't get back to me within these 10 days, you're now agreeing with me that you've got no claim. You cannot put a demand on me because you're agreeing with me. If you ignore me, you're agreeing with your silence. All I'm asking for is proof and I'll pay it. I'm not refusing to pay. Give them a second 10 days, but a clever bit. The way I never pay anything is I get them to owe more money than what they're claiming I owe them, if that makes sense. I'll explain what I mean. Second letter or notice, I give them 10 days. Now I'm getting a bit peeved, I'm spending a lot of time on this. You don't get angry, it's nice and polite. Give me these documents within 10 days, please. If not, if you don't get back to me, you're agreeing with your silence. Also, if you don't get back to me with what I want, you're also agreeing to pay my fee schedule of fees. Shit some right up. Nothing wrong. You jump in a taxi, what's it say on the meter? £2.70 a mile. They're telling you the schedule of fees. You go to a solicitor's, you might get a free half an hour. What do they say? Oh, I charge £200 an hour. They're telling you the schedule of fees. I'm a big believer in mirror it back. So now I say, second 10 days, this is my schedule of fees. I write a schedule out and send it to them. If they don't get back to me and don't get what I want, they're agreeing to my fee schedule. Second 10 days goes past, I've sent two letters. I've given them 14 days, I've given them 10 days. What's that, 24 days. It's like 3.5 weeks. Last 10 days goes past. I hit them. Boom. It's got many names. We call it an estoppel, which means to stop. An estoppel by acquiescence. In other words, you've not said anything back, so you must be in agreement. Agreement between the parties is no reason to go to court. They've agreed by their silence. If you keep saying to me, you owe me £5,000, you owe me £5,000, and I never get back to you, then I must owe you £5,000. Because if I didn't owe it, I'd say, no, then piss off, I don't owe you anything. Same with them. They've agreed by the silence. So, an estoppel by acquiescence means, that's it, time's up. I've given you time, nice and fair. All I've asked for is 3 documents, or 2. I've given you time, I've given you extra time. It's now taking my time when I'm busy doing other things. You've agreed by your silence. I don't want any more communication from you. If you send me any more communication, and you put it out on your fee schedule, I charge 500, you can make it unrealistic, you can make it millions of pounds, but I'll make it realistic, because I know I can cash in on it. I charge 500 quid for a phone call, or text message, or email. I charge £1,000 a letter after the time limit's gone that you've given them. And if anyone comes to my house, if I've sent a bill in and he's never paid up, I charge £3,000 per person per visit. And they've agreed to it because they've not argued back. So, this is what I do with council tax. I don't want to go into council tax too much, but we can do. I've asked them for original contracts and a live signed bill. Never had a sausage because they've got legislation behind them and think they can do what they want. Give them 14 days, gave them 10 days, sent them an estoppel. That's it. As far as I'm concerned, our business is concluded.
Is it entitled estoppel?
I just got, and by the way, I just handwrite everything.
Yeah.
I've had so much results just handwriting stuff. I don't know why, most people type it out, don't they? Maybe it's because it's in my own handwriting like they used to do hundreds of years ago. I've never been ignored when I handwrite things. You know, it's not a template letter or notice, it's me doing it under full commercial liability with a signature. Estoppel by acquiescence is what I call it. You can call it what you want, really. But that word estoppel's got some legal and lawful sort of meanings. You don't like it. So that's what I've done with council tax. Excuse me. After the time limit was up and the estoppel went out, I got a letter 2 weeks later, a supposed bill for, they're trying to bill me for 1,500 quid for council tax. What do you do? I sent the bill in immediately. Boom. £1,000 for letter. I also charge late payment charges, all on my fee schedule, they've agreed to it, and £100 a week interest. And they've agreed to it. So in the end now, they've leave me alone now, they don't come near me now. Council tax people, I mean I've billed them now, it's gone up since that, I can't even be asked to bill them. As of now, the council tax people owe me £4,500. They're billing me saying that I owe them 1,500 quid. Now, I'm going to move on to court a little bit, if anyone's interested in how court works and stuff. You probably know a lot about yourself. All a judge or a magistrate is in a court is he keeps the books. All he looks is who's a debtor, who's a creditor. Normally, council tax people take me to court, Rob Freeman owes 1,500 quid. Besides with corporations anyway, yeah, he's a debtor, that's why you lose every time. So, look what he's got now. Hang on, if it did ever go to court, which it can't do, that's why they won't take me. But let's say they do take me to court. What's a judge or a magistrate going to do? All he's there, that's why you're held accountable. It's not that you've done anything wrong, it's to balance the accounts. That's what it's all about. It's commerce, it's all about money. They call it statute law. Is it a diktat, Rob, you call it?
Yeah.
It's not a law, is it, mate? Yeah. I picked up on that.
I looked at that. Statutes become diktats. Forward as a diktat.
Yeah, there's no statute law. We know it's admiralty, it's all this stuff. It's commerce, isn't it? So what would a judge or magistrate do now? Okay, council tax people have got a valid claim in his eyes. Rob Freeman owes 1,500 quid. Oh, hang on a minute. Rob Freeman's got an equally valid claim that they owe him 4,500. All he's done is ask for documents, give him a time, put his time for his fee schedule in, which they've agreed to, and they've done nothing. So all that would happen in court is that I do owe them 1,500 quid. Never said I didn't, I just approve it. Now they owe me £4,500. All a judge or magistrate could do is offset it and get them to write me a cheque for £3,000. Well, they could do it every week for all that. They've been like a king on beach, weren't they? So nobody takes me to court. for money. This is why I've never been taken to court. And it's that simple process. Three things. Never refuse to pay it. Roger Hayes got locked up for withholding his council tax. I don't know why, he knows a lot more than I do, or he should do. No one's banging on my door, they didn't come. The reason being is, I've not refused to pay it, and I've not withheld it. I haven't done any of those things. I've just said, fucking prove I owe it. Show me some proof I owe it, I'll give you money, I'll go to the bank now. I ain't got it, I ain't got any money. But I said to him, just prove that I owe it, no problem. How can I ever be took to court? How can anybody take any action on me? What am I doing wrong?
But don't they override you? They just don't care what you send. They don't read what you send. The magistrates don't even look into your papers. What they do, they just...
The rubber stamping.
Yes.
Yeah, but the whole thing about legislation, this legal system, is they've still got a boundary, a mandate to work in. So because I don't know how many people have had success with council tax, TV license, stuff like that. But if you look what I'm actually doing, I'm not fighting them. I'm mirroring their system. I'm doing what they do to us. And so how can he? He's got a mandate, a set of rules, procedure to work to. I'm not breaking their procedure. They're mad on procedure. That's all they're bothered about. No. All I'm doing is mirroring their procedure. I'm doing nothing wrong. I'm not refusing. I'm not causing conflict. I'm not disputing the amount. I'm not doing anything. I'm not refusing to pay. And I'm not saying I'm withholding payment. It's bad. I think it's a bad phrase, personally. All I'm saying is, yeah, no problem. I'll pay it. No problem. Just give me a bit of proof. You can't lose. You cannot lose. And it applies to anything. It applies to any demand that anyone puts on you, financial. So I'm glad you mentioned court. Have a bit of chat about court, incidentally. Anybody? Yeah. Anybody appear in court? Come on, just stick your eye on me. I'll put mine on. How many got a good result?
Yeah.
It's a bit low, isn't it? Two. Yeah. Two out of about a mixture. Some good, some bad. Yeah. Well, magistrates caught most of it, were it?
I think stuff can, but magistrates
have had some good ones. Yeah, well, listen, every time I go, I take a tub of Vaseline and say, go on, because I just get shafted every time, but I don't now. Early days when doing the Freeman stuff, I say I got shafted. They just roughshod over you, don't they? They railroad you, don't they? Well, I used to see it as a victory or a loss, so I don't see it like that now. Any of us stand up there, we're standing as full commercial liability, they're hiding. So we've won anyway. I don't care what action they take on me, what they say. I've won because I'm stood there, I'm fighting the corner. And all I'm really saying is, prove that you've got some authority over me. If you haven't, sod off.
You can't. You serve them with a statutory declaration.
Again, it's down to, look, this is what I'm going to get at now. I know Dad's done a lot of work on this. I've tried legislation, statutory. Statutory means, they call it statutory law, it's not. It's got the force of law by consent. That's it. They can't tell you, nobody can tell you what to do, but what they can do is trick you into that consent through things like legalese and stuff, and bully boy tactics. You're using a statutory demand, if you're going down their route, you're going to lose every single time.
But a statutory declaration is a statement of truth.
But it's a statutory. I don't recognise anything to do with statutes, an act of parliament. It's an act, they're all acting, aren't they? I don't recognise it. It's the lowest form of law. It's not law, it's statute law. Because I hate using the word law. It's not law, is it? It's law by consent. The highest form of law is trust law, and I'm going to do a little bit about trust if we've got time. I know I've done a full talk, but I've got some other bits to show you. So yeah, stick with it, but if it's a statement of truth, why not just send a sworn out affidavit?
So what?
An affidavit sworn out.
It was just at that time I were advised that.
Not just you, I'm saying if you're going to make a statement of truth, I've sent an affidavit. I've got 3 hours sleep last night and 3 hours the night before. I've got a court case coming up and I need to get this paperwork in. And I've sent an affidavit sworn out with 3 witnesses have signed it, and I've signed it, and it's my statement of truth. So I'm staying away from the legalities. The nearer you can stay to common law, the more chance you're going to have. Yeah? So, yeah, we're going about court a little bit, because we're on that subject now. It's one of my favourite subjects. Okay. I've said this a few times, so a lot of you might have heard this, but... Okay, the old capital's name, sometimes it's like that, isn't it? That's that facility, that tool I was telling you about. Okay, how do you end up in court? Somebody puts a demand on you, don't they? And it causes conflict. You either don't pay or you don't do what you're supposed to do. The conflict is then adjudicated at this place, isn't it? Okay, the way they get there at first is this. Okay, remember I said some part of us is in there, but it's not all of us. It's like me. You could say he's a male. So you fit into categories. He's a male, he's under 50, he's got a big nose, he looks foreign, he's a parent, he's a single parent, so you fit into categories. I am a parent, I have got a big nose, I am foreign looking, but that's not the whole me, is it? That's some part of me is in there. In the same way, if you look at that, that's the same thing. Don't fear this. Never fear this. We can use this. We can use this. I do use it. Okay. So what they do is, they look at your address, and all they do is, it's back to casting. They cast a net. It's a fishing expedition. They lob it at my house, at everyone's house, see if you can get a bite. Most people, 95% of people, if that was their name, think that's them, didn't it? Your mum and dad didn't call you Mr, did they? No, your mum and dad just called you Rob, didn't they, or Robert? They don't write Rob Freeman in block capitals on your birthday card, do they? So we just associate with it, don't we, and think it's us. So they cast a net and they wait for a buy. Most people buy, don't they? They give you a demand. So they wait for a buy. What else bites from a net? Fish, innit? What happens to a fish? It gets caught. It's as simple as that. And that's what happens, we get caught. Because we think that's us. So we've got a caught, don't we, thinking that's us. I forgot where I'm up to now, Rob. I've lost myself there. What am I talking about fish for?
That'd be interesting though.
Anyway, well, it's water world, isn't it, we're living. You know about Admiralty Law, that's where we are. Fish. That's funny, isn't it? Yeah. You have a school of fish, don't you? And we've got a school, don't we? So we fish, aren't we?
And that's why we get caught.
Okay, so it is a straw man name. It's also a trust, like Alex says, but I'm going to mention that in a bit, only briefly. Yeah, so it's all these things. Oh, that's where I were. So some part of me is in there, isn't it? So that's what I'm saying, don't fear, but it's not all the whole me. Some part of me is in there, it's a facility and a tool. It's a corporation, it's a straw man, it's a legal fiction name, it's many, many things. It's also a trust. Okay, so we relate to that because some part of us is in there. That's the point I was trying to make. So we go along to court, don't we? Yeah, I'll rub that name out. What? Who said that?
Marty.
Oh, lovely. Can't even see you back there. Are you alright? Okay, a speedo ticket. I've got the speedo. I used to wear them when I was young. Speedos. Okay, so we go on to court, don't we? Tell you what. I've been a quick note here. Just have a quick look at this note. What I want to do is explain what a court is. Now, this could take like 3 weeks to explain what it is. There's loads of things going off in court. Ah, here we go. This is what I wanted to get to. Okay. Any court matter that's statutory based or a civil matter or administration, whatever you want to call it, it's admiralty law and all this bollocks, isn't it? All it is about money. That's all it is. Nothing else. Simple. It's not about justice. It's not about whether you were speeding. That's me. Okay. So it's a camera, whatever, I don't pay it, I just ignore it. Causes conflict, boom. I've been caught, goes there. Cops or whoever they are, they've got me, I owe 300 quid for speeding, whatever. Okay? That's me turning up under full commercial liability. You don't get took to court for speeding, okay? You're getting took to court for breach of contract, believe it or not. Even though we know there's no contract in place, that's what you're getting took to court for. Let's say it's not a camera, let's say it's a cop has pulled you over, sat him back at car, what does he give you? He gives you the offer of a fixed penalty notice, doesn't he? Or go to court and argue your case. Either way, you're on a loser. What's the fixed penalty notice? It's an offer of a contract. That's all it is. He's offering you the chance to take the contract and pay 150 quid instead of 300 quid. That's it, that's all he's doing. Remember what I said about these people, even the police, the courts, everybody, the corporations, all they can do is extend the offer of the contract. Well, they dress it up to look different and be more threatening. So what do? Is they offer you a fixed penalty notice. It's a notice. Let's have a look at it. It's a notice. It's only a notice. a penalty, and it's fixed. So you're agreeing through their notification to accept a penalty, and it's fixed at a certain rate, 150 quid, if you decide that you want to pay it there and then, or within a certain amount of time. So that's all it is. It's an offer of a contract. But you get back at police car, he wants your details, and he wants you to sign, really, so you panic, because he's a copper in a uniform. He's only extending a contract, have you? So, you get took to court for breach of a contract. Now, we know there's no contract, but they say there is. They always side with the corporations. What does he see on his account books? That I'm a debtor. You're not getting done for speeding, you're getting done for not paying the financial demand. Yeah? So, that's a speeding fine. So every time you turn up, anyone puts a demand on you, and it's usually financial, they are always together. Why are they always together? Because whether that's coppers, police, whatever for speeding, whether it's a big corporation saying you owe money, whatever it is, this entity and this entity are all performing a function of government. You're performing a function of government because if you're doing anything legal, if you're operating in commerce, if this is a corporation, this could be ASDA, whoever it is, it can be Orange mobile phone, it could be anybody. They're a corporation performing a function of government. It gets onto trust, so I'll explain that in a bit. Courts performing a function of government. This is the same entity. Talk about conflict of interest. They both work for the same people. What chance have we ever got? That's why we lose 97% of the time. They allow us 3% victories to keep the illusion of justice going. If you could do it, if you wanted to, 100% we'd pay every time. So what's your punishment? It's money, isn't it? It's always pay, isn't it? It's always pay. So they both work for the same entity. How come we can't take them down the legal route, guys? I've tried it. The conflict of interest. It should be. They're both working for the same people. What about me? I've got Crown Prosecution Service next week, trying to get me driving whilst disqualified. It's gone on for nearly 6 months now. Crown Prosecution Service, magistrates, what about a conflict? What chance have I got in 6 days' time when I go? It's a conflict of interest. Two different masks on the same face. What chance have I got? I haven't, have I? But I'm going to tell you in a bit after I've finished this bit, it is all that, but it's also a trust. I've tried to get magistrates, judges on fraud, everything, and everything I do, they won't wear it because they're all working together. And believe it or not, every time we get done in court, they're doing absolutely nothing wrong, these people. They're not doing anything wrong. It took me a good 2 years to get my head around this. I kept trying this Freeman stuff and thinking, I didn't get beat, but I didn't lose either. It was kind of a stalemate. And this is trying to do that legal stuff, guys, and I kept thinking, well, they're breaking law, they're illegal themselves, because how can two people working for the same person, it's all one entity, what chance have I got? Is that not a con? How can he judge impartially if the same people that he's working for is all one? I thought it's illegal. And what I realised is it's not. He's not done anything wrong. Because what's happening in court is there's a trust going off. Okay? Okay, I didn't want to get onto trust yet, but I'll explain briefly. There's three parts to a trust, basically. I'll do it in short. There's a beneficiary, we'll call it an executor. I've done that on that other talk. Or administrator. And there's a trustee. Okay? I've done all this before, so. So somebody says something then?
Isn't there a fourth? The heir.
The heir?
The heir. The heir to the trust.
Okay.
Everything's been held in trust for.
That's the beneficiary, that.
That's the beneficiary.
That's the person that gets the benefit from that trust. Yeah. It might be called a heir sometimes, it might be called all sorts, but in effect, it's a beneficiary, yeah? Okay. Sometimes the executor is called administrator. Okay. I'm going to run through this quick because I've done a big talk on this. Beneficiary, trust set up for that person to get maximum benefit. Executor or administrator runs the policy of that trust solely for the purpose of that person there. A trustee gets told what to do by this person and has to do everything this person says for the benefit, once again, of the beneficiary. So, I'm not going to spend too much time on this because there's other talks on this. What happens when we go to court? Why is there no conflict of interest and why do we lose every time? And more importantly, why are they doing nothing wrong? They're doing nothing wrong because you went to court, it's a trust, but they don't tell you it's a trust. Okay, based on these three positions, what's happening in court? This is what happens when, if I didn't know anything, in the next week when I go, this is what would happen. I would be, I'd be entering as a trustee. Okay? Judge or magistrate?
Executor
or administrator. Why? I'll tell you why. I'll call him admin. He administrates, doesn't he? Okay. We've got to scribble writing all that, isn't it? We've got a court, we don't know, imagine we don't know what we're doing, which I've used to years ago. I turn up. Okay. Someone's taking me to court. Turn up, go in court, what happens? They tell me when to come in. Tell me where to stand. Tell me to swear on a Bible or whatever. They put me in a dock. We know it's admiralty law and all that stuff, but they put me in a dock. And what do they say? How do you plead? They won't plead, legally speaking.
So you go in the dock?
Great stuff.
I won't go in. It's under their jurisdiction. Yes, go on anyway.
But because I know this now, Dale, next week I'm actually going to stand in. I'm defending myself in a 3-hour trial.
Yeah.
And I'm going to actually, because the prosecution go first, which is them.
Yeah.
I'm going to actually stand in the dock. I'm going to have a bit of a laugh. Forget it wrong, man. I'll get 6 months prison.
I'm
not going to get it wrong. I've got it right. But I'm actually going to stand in the dock this time. But before I do stand in the dock,
yeah,
I'm going to say, can you just tell me, in any way, do I lose any of my inherent rights by standing here? In fact, I'll tell them, I'm not giving up any rights by standing in your invisible dock. Yeah. Because trust law is higher than statute or admiralty law. And I'm going in with the trust relationship. Well, so I can stand where I want.
So if you're telling them that, it's almost like you're putting them on notice of that. So even if you are in that jurisdiction, even if they put you, they call that jurisdiction, at least you're making it very clear to them.
Yes.
Even though you're stood there, you're standing on what you're on and not what they think you're on.
Exactly. So, and I've already informed them, I've sent my papers off today, this is why I look bollocks, because I've been up last two nights getting on the
company.
Papers ready. Pardon?
Company.
Is bollocks. I get emails saying, are you Rob Bollocks?
Yeah.
I've had it for 6 months. I said, no, I'm Rob Freeman.
I
said, I said, he's a great speaker, Rob. I said, no, I'm Rob Freeman, but I just look bollocks all the time.
Yeah.
So, how do I get on email and text messages, are you Rob Bollocks? No, I'm just fucking bollocks. Where were I, Del?
So,
they're not doing anything wrong because there's no conflict of interest because it's a trust, but they don't tell us it's a trust. I walk in, I get told what to do, I need to plead, I need to beg, which means beg, I get told what to do, I'm acting like a trustee. Yeah? Okay, if I'm a trustee, when we first go in, someone's got to volunteer to administer that proceedings while nobody is. They've got an obligation to do it, this is why they're doing nothing wrong. So they act as executor or more specific administrator, it's the same thing. So they've got a responsibility to do that, haven't they? Because nobody else is doing it. I'm acting like a trustee. I'll show you what it's like for company law in a sec, exactly the same thing. I'm acting like a trustee, he's got an obligation to come forward because nobody else is. Remember what I said about what's his sole purpose? His sole purpose in life is to administer that policy for the sole beneficiary, for the sole benefit of the beneficiary. So hang on a minute, three parts to a trust. I'm a trustee, he's administrator executor, well, who's beneficiary? Well, believe it or not, these knobs who are bringing me to court are actually the beneficiaries. What? How can they be beneficiaries? Well, they are, because a trust estate has equity in it, yeah? The equity is being entrusted and looked after by these people, right? Rob Freeman is, in capital letters or a title or whatever, is a trust, it's a trust estate. A trust and an estate is the same thing. They want something out of my equity. They're claiming that they want 500 quid off me. It's a benefit for them to get money from my trust, my equity. So they become a beneficiary. Now look how we lose in court. It's not just because corporations are all working together. It's because the sole purpose of an administrator executor is to solely work for the benefit of the beneficiary. He's doing nothing wrong. I'm turning up as a trustee. My own choice is voluntary. I'm acting like a trustee because I don't know what's going after her. So, based on trust law, which is the highest law, can you see that they're not doing anything wrong? Yeah. They're not doing anything wrong, are they?
Because you've got ignorance of the lies, no excuse, they keep telling you.
Is what, Dale?
They keep saying ignorance of the lies, no excuses, they keep saying.
Ignorance is no excuse, is it? So, what are they doing wrong? Absolutely nothing. So, remember I said don't fight them and mirror it back. I've recognised what they're doing. Hang on a minute. I looked at trust a couple of years ago, it only just dawned on me these last 6-9 months. No wonder we can't get a great victory. It's bloody trust law, it's the highest form of law you can do. So let's just mirror it back. So all I do is, and I've been through this, so I'm not going to carry on with it. Reappoint. Hang on a minute. Rob Freeman in all capitals, or Mr. Rob Freeman, it doesn't matter what they call me, you can call me what you want, you can stand me in dog, you can do what you want. I'll let them know beforehand, before I go in, and I'll let them know on the day. Hang on a minute. Call me what you want. Write my name how you want, say anything about me what you want, but this is what's really going off, and I tell them, okay. Then three positions, you can only ever be one position. If you're trustee, that's the only position you can hold. You can be both beneficiary and executor together. You can have those two positions. You can't have all three or it won't be a trust. You can be beneficiary, you can be executor, or the other option is you can be a trustee, but you can only ever be a trustee in that capacity at any one time. So if you're a trustee, you can't be anything else. Bear that in mind, but you can be these two if you so decide. I didn't want to spend any time on this. I'll have to. Okay, so now when I go into court, right, I let them know that I am the beneficiary of my trust, which I am. It was set up for me, wasn't it? I've now decided to direct policy of my trust. I am now executor of my trust. Nobody can, they can't argue about it. Every time I've done it, their heads go down.
I've had
you know, the clerk to the justices sliding down in the chair thinking, oh, fucking hell, you know that. It's just come to me, I know it's right. I've had barristers squirming, now I'm just a fat lump from Sheffield, off a council estate. These rich, bloody half £1 million a year, they don't know what to do with me. They're looking at each other. Magistrates are not legally trained, they don't know much. The legal advisor's searching for someone, how's he know this? Shit, what can we do? Well, all I've done is call me what you want, reappoint your positions, which is right, it's my trust. Rob Freeman's trust is my trust.
You know, when you, before you go into court, do you do it through your affidavit when you put it in that you're.
I've done that now,
yeah,
though. Normally, I'll just go in and blaze in and say, you trustee, go off, leave me alone, and I walk out and dismiss it. But I got arrested as a no show after that because he didn't know what to do with me. So this time round, I've notified them through an affidavit. And I invite them, Del, I say, if I'm wrong, prove to me that I'm wrong.
Proof of claim, well done,
again, just ask them, say, this is how I see it, if I'm wrong, tell me I'm wrong. And nobody ever does, because they can't. That's right. My trust, if you believe in God, which I don't, either God or whoever created you gave you free dominion, to travel planet Earth and do exactly what you want, as long as, remember that one law, do no harm to another living soul, and nobody's got any rights on you, and that's what I do. So based on my trust with my creator, some people call him God, that's brilliant, if you believe in God, no problem. My creator gave me my trust, it's between me and him. How can these people come between it? They can't. So what they do is switch it round. What we've got to do, simple, switch it back, you've got no argument. Okay, so now I am the executor and beneficiary, which can hold those two positions, yeah? Hang on a minute. Excuse me. That's supposed to be magistrates, or judges or whatever. I've just put courts, haven't I? Okay, so if I'm the beneficiary and executor, who are that? Who's that? Okay. It's for.
If he's a court official and they're supposed to be inside constitutional fold of government, which is supposed to have got their robes of court, then they're serving us, the people, so there should be a trustee, because they can't obviously be the beneficiary, because they're serving us.
Excellent.
They claim they're off of court, they say they're supposed to look after us, uphold the law and all the rest of it. They can't be both ways. Do you know what I mean?
They are, aren't they? But because, that's because nobody else is doing it until now.
What you're saying, Rob, that the
court was operating as a trust. So the court itself has got the...
Oh, brilliant. Well, I'm coming to that now. I want to tell you how courts work, but yeah, I'll get on to that. Just hold that thought for a minute, so I'll tell you how it works. Nice one. So magistrates, judges swore oaths as public servants. What does public servant, nice one, don't I know? They're serving us. Government's not there to control or rule us, it's there in service to us. You, me, we're the highest power. As a human sentient being, correct, there's no higher power than us. That's why they can't get between us and God or us and our Creator. Mm-hmm. And when they're not working in their capacity as a judge or a barrister, then they've got the same as us. But they've chosen to act in a capacity of service, which makes you, as Del rightly says, a trustee. They're our trustees there. They swore an oath. So they are trustees. Trustees is the shit end of the stick of the three positions. You can only ever be trustee, you can't be anything else. If you swore an oath, by definition, you're a trustee. So now what's happened to judge and magistrates? They become, look at my writing, it's like Spanish or something. They become trustees, don't they? So hang on a minute, I'm executor beneficiary, he's now trustee. What does a trustee have to do? Exactly what the executor or minister tells him to do for the benefit of the beneficiary. Sorted. Hang on a minute. CPS. Oh, were they then? Crown, prosecution, service. Doing service again, aren't they? But what if it's not CPS? What if it's Tesco? Putting a demand on me. They've not swore oaths, have they?
Actually, neither have councils.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, if they're taking you against contract, that is, you can come back to contract.
You can.
Can they provide
proof
of claim?
Yeah, but we're superseding that now because, that's what I meant earlier. I think you've just realised, haven't you, mate? Before a contract can even take place, there has to be a trust relationship formed. Mm-hmm. If I don't know you, Del, I won't just come up to you and say, oh, mate, want to enter a contract with me? You'd say, what? Yeah. You weirdo. What are you smoking? But if we know each other, we've built what's an implied trust relationship at least. And we might be sat and bump into each other. And you say, hey, Rob, I've got a great idea. You fancy like DJing or something? And we'll... So the contract arises. This is what I mean. I've took it back further than common law and contracts, where contracts started. There has to be a trust relationship first that extends then maybe into a contract. And then from that contract is when you get problems and breaches of contract, yeah?
Yeah.
So it might be Tesco. They've not sworn off, have they? It could be any.
Can I just say something about sucess? Just a bit of background, really, why it is the highest form of law.
Okay.
Trust law comes under one of the three high courts, which is known as the Chancery or the Equity Court. It was originally known as the Court of the King's Conscience and was administered by the Chancellor. King James I. Said that if there is a conflict between common law and the law of equity, the law of equity wins. And it was there for when the common law was being unfair with contracts. So if you wanted to find out more about it, if you look up the Court of Chancery, one of the three high courts, and look about the law of equity, you'll find a lot of information about that there, the way it is, the highest court.
Okay, nice one. It is, and you agree it is the highest court, but it
is,
isn't it?
Yeah.
It is. Okay, nice one for that. Yeah, so we'll finish off on this, because I just want to go on to some other things about court, and about other things. Okay, so Tesco have not sworn oath, any corporate entity has not sworn oath. So, can they be trustees? Yes, they still are trustees. I'll tell you why. Anyone who's performing a function of government. Remember I said the national insurance number and all that?
Collecting tax.
Anything. Any function of government, operating in commerce, running a business, you're performing a function of government. If you're performing any function of government, you automatically become a trustee. There's no two ways about it, okay? So now what's happened here? Look at my writing. So I'm tired. Okay, so all you've done is rearrange things. Anybody bringing you to a claim against you is a company, it's a corporation, a limited liability corporation. They become a trustee. Now he becomes a trustee. I call the shots, and that's what's happening. So I'll just tell you briefly, that's how it works. If you're having trouble understanding this, which a lot of people, it's simple, But it takes a real lot of thinking, it did with me for ages. Understand the trust, exactly. Think of a company. Think of a company. I don't know. Any company. What does it have?
M&S.
Yeah. Okay, what does it have?
Shareholders.
It has a shareholder, or shareholders. It has a...
chief executive.
Yeah, well, I'll call it director, but yeah, because for our purposes, but somebody is going to run that company for the shareholders. Yeah? And it has, I didn't do this last time, it has employees. Yeah? Look at it for our purposes. Company law, corporation law is exactly the same, really. It's trust, it mirrors it. Shareholder, what's a shareholder? They've got equity.
They put some.
The administrators and beneficiaries.
Not administrators, but they are beneficiaries, you're right.
The director of what to do.
They do, yeah. The beneficiary tells.
I won't hold your carry on.
No, no. The executor or administrator, his sole purpose is for the beneficiary in a trust, yeah? The company director, his sole purpose is to make profit for the shareholder. So he's got equity in there. He's got some value in there. So what is he? That's his value. Shareholder is, if it was trust law, he's a beneficiary, yeah? He can decide to run that company, this shareholder. If he wants, he can run that company, can't he? But he wants to sit on his arse and drink cocktails on beach. So he employs somebody, doesn't he? A company director. What's a company director? He's an executor, isn't he? His sole purpose, remember, is to do everything for the benefit. So I'll just finish off on this. So, employees get told what to do by this chap for the benefit of the shareholder. So an employee is a trustee. That says trustee. So can you see why anybody performing a function of government is an employee of the government? National insurance number evidences that you are a government agent, a government employee. So when they are acting in that capacity, they are an employee, which is a trustee, and get told what to do. Remember, they can only hold that one position in a trust as trustee, yeah? Okay, so I'll get rid of that. Shout up if anybody wants a break or whatever. Sometimes described as the beneficiary has a right over the trustee. He actually is in severe breach if he abuses that trust. He's got an obligation, hasn't he?
The fiduciary's highest duty is the loyalty to the beneficiary.
That's it, exactly.
So if they breach their loyalty to the beneficiary in any way, well, and that, I think the words were something that they've got a, something higher than the normally trodden by the crowd or something, which related that they have to work harder than everybody else.
Right, and it's an obligation and a right for the beneficiary,
yeah,
while they're acting in trustee capacity. So how can a judge, magistrate or whatever act against us? When they are acting against us, and I want to come to this now, is because they are acting in the capacity of executor, administrator, because we're letting them. They're not doing anything wrong. Someone's got to come forward. We're not doing it because we're like cheap, aren't we? We're walking to court like that. Go and stand there. What's your name? We're acting like employees. So what we've got to do is swap it round. And then now they are in breach of trust because you just rearrange the positions. But hold on a minute, I'm rocking out of my great point here. Rob Freeman turns up to court. It's my trust between me and God. Rob Freeman's trust. What I found out, very interesting. I forgot to mention it on that talk, which is why I wanted to get it in now. It's now. When the court people come out for the first hearing, you go along. It's Admiralty Court, as we know. You stand in the dock, like we said. It's water world, isn't it? We are fish in court. Most people fall down at that point, so there's no need to know anything else. Early Freeman stuff, I didn't fall down at that point. I argued a good case. Common law name wouldn't stand in the dock. We thought, oh, okay, we've got a bit of a clever lad here. What do? They recess immediately. I've had judges and magistrates. I would have been the first person ever to arrest a judge or a magistrate before Roger Hayes, 3 weeks before. I mean, they had been my two mates with me. And I tried to get them and they ran off because I put them on their oath. Just me on my own. Call for security of law. 2 weeks later, district judge. He must have been having whiskey back, his face was bright red, he kept shouting. Tried to arrest him, he ran off. So I kept abandoning ship. So first it's maritime law stuff, innit? So what did they do? They recessed. They're only allowed to recess twice. I got better of them, they went into the back. And they come back out. Now they're all being clever again. I thought, shit, what's happened? I've just hammered you and you've had a recess. What they don't tell you is, Okay, you go to court, just before they come out, backstage I call it, because they're all actors. What they do is, 5 minutes before they come out, they have what's called a case management hearing. I don't know where I've got this from, I've never found it from anywhere else, but I've checked it out, it is right. It's not a case management hearing. They're forming what's called a constructed trust, or a constructive trust. Constructed trust. They're constructing a trust before they come out. They're sorting it out between them. Whoever's brought to court, the judge and magistrates, they're constructing a trust, making me the trustee without my knowledge. So, first time they come out, maritime law, most people fall down, we never get to know. I start talking about Freeman stuff. What do? They recess. What do? They come back out again. If I know about trust stuff, which I've done, forget maritime stuff, I get took to court, I hit him immediately with the trust stuff. Rob Freeman, it's my trust. You swore public, you swore oaths, you're public servants, you're trustees. You, performing a function of government, you're a trustee. I'm the beneficiary, I'm the executor, I order you to dismiss all charges. I've got them. As soon as I walked in, what do? Recess. Recess. Come back out, they construct a trust. Now they're judging, not on the Rob Freeman trust, on the trust they've just constructed. They've put me back, it's a game, they switch back. They've put me back to trustee. So what I said last time I went, they recessed, they come back out. I said, oh, by the way, your little constructed trust you've just created, I dissolve it. And they looked at each other and went, shit, how's he know that? The reason I could dissolve it verbally, any trust can be created verbally or on paper. We could have a trust between us three verbally. We're going to prove it to anyone, it's our trust between us.
High trust, express trust.
Yeah. So, they construct a trust and come back out, and because they constructed it verbally, I said, I dissolve your trust, and they looked at each other and went, shit. So they all did you want to say something, Dad?
No, keep going, just see what you're right.
Okay.
You're right, and that age is supposed to have, like, you do that, what you said, three phrases, but they do it because they go out, they change the roles, and they change the cuts, like, canon, they change it.
I'm coming out to that, you start, you're going to have a pint on me, man. Yeah, so all this is going off, and I'm noticing stuff, all this bollocks is going off, but what's not going off is any form of justice. Oh, I've got to tell you about justice, what it really means. I found out, I said it last time. I'll tell you a bit. You can only be here till midnight. So, they're only allowed to recess twice. You can only come out three times in total. So, I'm on to them. I dissolve your constructed trust, they go back out again. They come back out, they can only go back straight. So, three times you face them. You're not allowed to do that. Each time, they're coming out to what they think is a higher jurisdiction. I'm going to explain what it is. Again, if you come back out, I dissolve your constructed trust again. It's like a game of chess, isn't it? But this time, we've been playing chess with them for years, but we've been wearing boxing gloves and bloody blindfolds, haven't we? Gloves are off now, and I've put some holes in my blindfold. I can see what's happening now on your Masonic chessboard. So, all it is a trust. So, I'm not fighting them, I'm not arguing. I'm rearranging what's happening. So, I dismiss all charges. By the way, I keep forgetting this. I'm putting it on the public record. As soon as I walk in, I used to say, as Freeman, is everything that happens here on the record? Well, it's just a trustees meeting. They can have a private record because they can alter it. So as soon as I walk in, I say to them, is everything that's happening now a matter of public record? Every answer, every time they say, yes, it's a public building. I say to them, well, in that case, I didn't ask that question. They say, it's a public building. I say, that's not what I said. This is what I tell them. No wonder they want to kill me. I say, I'm now convening a court of public record. And they look at me as if to say, he looks dumb, but he's quite smart, him. And so I'm convening the court, it's my trust, isn't it? Okay, so, dissolve the trust and all that bollocks. The admiralty stuff's going off as well, but something far more sinister's going off, and that we don't know about, or we do now. Okay, so all that with that trust crap is all going off all at once. But worse still, this is going off. And I'll let me find my notes, because you're going to like this, or maybe not. I've got something else to tell you about. I'll leave that. Okay, what we're being judged by is every time they go out and construct a trust, which they are doing, well, what they're doing is, each and every everything. and giving us nothing. And we're like Muppets, we're like employees trustees. We're like shelf stackers at Tesco, we don't know what we're doing. So we walk in as trustees, employees, we don't know. And now we're starting to fight back and get a few results. So every time the recess, not adjourned, but recess for 5 minutes, come back out, they keep constructing trust. But not only are they constructing trust, they're doing this. Okay, this is far more sinister. This is why we cannot win. I can't write, we're being judged by sacred law. A trust is trust between us and God, innit, or us and Creator. So we're being judged by sacred law. All roads lead to Rome.
Yeah,
it's Vatican. The Vatican run everything. The Vatican, alongside the Crown Corporation, but the Vatican law. Has anyone noticed number 11 keeps coming up lately?
Yeah.
Has anybody noticed it? Just so as an aside, human beings are classed as number 9. God is classed as number 10. Number 11 keeps coming up because now these psychos running things are that far gone. They believe that they are number 11, one above God. If anyone ever remembers a program that used to be called Room 101, does anyone remember it? 101 really means 11. They think now they are above God. In fact, I think 101 was a reference in,
1984.
Yeah, brilliant, yeah. Went it, that's where it first come from. Number 9, human being. Number 10, God. Number 11, they think that's them. I think they've got a right, this is how, they think they could, nobody can come between me and God and my trust, can they? They've hijacked it through the Vatican. Okay, so I'll try and get through it pretty quick. Sacred law is what's happening. Sacred law, why? French, it comes from an old French language. We're being judged by sacred law. Okay. Ooh, how can I condense this? Okay. The reason we never win among them all on other things is that we're not going to a court. They never call it a court of law, do they? But it's not. There's no law there. We're not entering a court, we're entering a church. It's a church. It's satanic. Again, back to the Vatican. We've all got original sin. We can look at, are you a debtor? Like I said, a creditor. We breached our contract. We did this. We're trustees. It's all important, but none of it really matters because we're all sinners. We were all born with this stain of original sin. How can we ever win in court? What we're really going to do, that's why it's called a court hearing. All law originally was heard. They'd have you believe it's all on paper. Well, it is now. Originally, law started through the word hearing. That's why you go to a hearing. What you're going for is they're hearing your confession. You've got a court, even if you have a solicitor, your solicitor's not trying to get you off, he's trying to cut you a lesser deal. He's trying to get you 50 Hail Marys punishment instead of 100. That's all he's doing, man. He's not working on your behalf at all. We are sinners, every one of us. So if we're sinners, they're hearing our confession. So hang on a minute. What's a judge or a magistrate? Well, you're not going to believe it, but they are priests. I presume a lot of people know about this stuff. Yeah, that's what I'm glad you agree. So it's not just me talking bollocks, is it?
You put bail at the bottom, Peter. I just want to be a bit humble. You just put bail at the bottom because the priest of bail.
Say again.
Bail at the bottom. The priest of bail. Just put bail at the bottom.
Nope. Hang on a sec. By any chance, do you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, man. Okay, some of them know, some of them don't, but them at the top do know. So, first time they recess, and they are constructing trust, it's Admiralty Maritime Law. Come back out again, higher jurisdiction, they're still constructing a trust because they're throwing every single weapon they can at us. But what are they doing second time? They've moved up a notch. It's trust law, and it's, I can explain it. Well, let's call it trust law. It's trust law, which is higher than Admiralty Statute Law. Second, then they recess again. The last time they come out, it's Roman Vatican Canon, the highest sacred law.
Whatever you want to call it, it's canon,
yeah. Yeah, you know what I'm saying. It's the Vatican cult. It's right at the top.
But it is, yeah, cult law.
The reason we can't win is the Pope, the Vatican City, he is the Vicar of Christ.
Correct.
There's God. There's God, there's the Pope, there's us sinners. these people, these priests, these high priests.
Correct.
High priests of Saturn, well, that's another
Saturn,
story.
Saturn, yeah.
These high priests are directly below the Pope. That's why everything's on paper. It's papal. That's why you pay PayPal on your computer. It's all roads lead to Rome. It's a Vatican cult of Rome. With the Jesuits in tow. And a nasty group called Knights of Malta, who are the hitmen for them.
The Knights of Columbus as well.
Well, the Knights of Malta are the Sovereign Military Order of Malta. They're the hitmen, the Black Ops. Right, starve people out of countries. They're the horrible people. Okay, so I'm waffling. Sacred law, how can we ever win? Every time they recess, they come back. That's why we can never win. Okay, so we are sinners when we're walking there and we're being judged by a priest. So you might say, how am I having success? Well, it is a church and it is satanic, but they can only get between me and God if I let them. At the moment, they can't do it. So I asked them, I asked them to tell me what is it, not to the judges, to whoever's bringing me to court, what are you saying I cannot do? What evidence have you got? What are you claiming to claim? Claim one of the most important things, you're claiming it. I could claim a right. What are you claiming that I cannot do? Show me evidence. And now, I'm not standing up for my rights and saying I claim the right to do this and I believe this and I've got this. What I'm saying is, negate all that, forget all that shit. For instance, I know it's not you, but imagine you're taking me to court for something. I'm going to ask CPS, I'm saying, what are you claiming I cannot do? What evidence have you got? Prove to me, prove to this court, so I'm no longer falling out with judges and magistrates because it don't work. Sacred law, remember. I'm asking, the burden of proof is on you. What are you claiming I cannot do? Show these magistrates and show me some proof or evidence to back up your claim. What can I not do? And in that respect, it's thrown back onto them and there never is a claim, is there? Not when it's a statute court. For a crime, a proper crime, where there's an injured party, for instance, if I smash your car and nick your wallet, then he'll come forward and sign an affidavit, a sworn, and there's an injured party. It's called corpus delicti or cause of action. He's willing to stand up on oath and say, he's hit me, took me money and smashed my car. Well, I deserve what I get then, because I've caused harm. But if I'm going 45 miles an hour in a 30 zone, where's the injured party? Where's the corpus delicti? There is none. So he can't back his claim up, because there is no claim. Nobody's been injured. So, sacred law, I'm mirroring it back. I'm acknowledging that there is a sacred law, but in a roundabout way, I'm saying to the judges and magistrates, claim that you've got superiority on my trust with God.
Standing.
I say to the magistrates, provide me a seal that warrants you've got some authority. Oh, remember, I've dissolved their trust. Provide me a seal that warrants that you've got authority over my trust right now. And they can never do it because they can't. They work on what's called a legal presumption. Everything's presumed. And all you've got to do is take that presumption away, which is what I do. So as we stand now, and this is why I want us to get together and start doing things and start learning. Because 2-3 years down the line, excuse my language, we've fucked it. Because they are going to become number 11. They're going to supersede us. Most people are walking around like zombies, we're not. So I want to get this stuff out, and I've repeated some of the stuff I've done on the last one, I didn't want to. But this is how vitally important it is. This is what's happening in court. All these things are happening all at once, and we don't know. And we can't do much about it until now. Now we can. Now we know what it is. It's maritime. It's trust. It's statute. It's contract law. It's everything. But most important is they're direct to the Pope. They are directly linked with God, which makes us below them. Well, it's done. Because prove to me with a seal that you can get my trust is with God. Nobody can come between me and my God. Now I'm telling them, prove it now or get out of my trust. Because you're acting in breach of trust. and that's all.
Your case.
Reporting up your fundamental freedoms have been involved in
and it's laws of God, isn't it? Yeah. You've got your inherent rights.
They can't do it. This is where we rob is to go on that same level. It's because they know they can't provide proof of claim on.
No, they can't. All you've done is take away that presumption. Yeah. They presume now. If anyone's been, you cannot ever, ever, ever get banned or get in trouble. You can never be disqualified from driving. Do you know that? I aim to prove it in 6 days' time. You can never be disqualified from driving. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you want to have it? Human rights to be able to
no, well, it. Human rights a little bit comes into it.
We've seen this. Have you seen this later?
That's quality, is that? I love that.
Yeah, you've seen mine later, haven't you?
That sent me that 2 days ago, didn't you, mate?
Quality.
I've been saying it now for 5 years.
I've got a copy of that.
Do you mind it being passed around?
It's on the Freedom Northwest
okay.
Website. Please, yes, please.
I've been saying this for 5 years now. Daz sent it me 2 or 3 days ago. Have a look at this. Do you want to have a break? And I'll get into this.
Maybe somebody could read it while it's written because not everybody.
Have a break. Have 5 minutes. Yeah, thanks a lot. And I can't believe no one's asleep. So, nice one. Okay, I don't know where we got to. I can't carry on with this sacred law stuff. And if Rob agrees, I'll come back. And I don't. If you're interested, I'll do a lot more on this. This is fundamentally how and why we're being enslaved. What's being used against us that we don't know of. And I don't. Is Del still here? He's still here. It's very, very deep and very, for want of a better word, it's satanic, basically. However you want to comprehend the word satanic, that's what's happening at the top level by the people that are running things. People talk about Illuminati and Freemasons and all these Bilderbergers and all these different groups, and they all are playing a horrible, horrible major part in our enslavement. But my research, and I've put thousands of hours in, which is why I'm knackered all the time, is that the Vatican cult is at the top. All roads lead to Rome. If anybody is religious, I'm not having a go at religion, I'm not having a go at Christianity. We're Roman Catholics, my mum's Italian, so I've grown up with this. I'm not having a go at anything like that. What I'm having a go at is the lie that they've sold to us and we've bought. Now, we don't have to buy it. And we've all got a responsibility. We've all played a part in this enslavement, every one of us. They've sold us a lie, but we didn't have to buy into that lie, did we? And we all have done. We don't have to any longer now, and we don't feel bad, we were tricked into it. So now let's get off as arses and turn it back round and see for what it is. And it might be horrible for some people who are really deeply religious, and it might be painful for some people, and it is. Many a time I've sat on me, I'm a single parent, kids are asleep, 3, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. It's not just about not paying bills, it's about the whole thing, the chemtrails, 9/11, poisonous food, the whole bloody spectrum. Is all satanic. And when you see it for what it is, the bit not paying bills, imagine a circle, it's just a small part of the whole equation. The whole thing, we've been tricked and deceived, and the evil that is happening in the world is really a consequence of our apathy. We've let it happen, willingly or unwillingly, and now it's time to stop it. We can't fight them, but what we can do is mirror it back and turn it back round. Stop being apathetic, start questioning, hold them accountable, well, fuck off, so excuse me. So, sacred law and all that, I'll do that next time. Disqualification for driving, that's what I'm in for. I don't want to just talk about my own thing, but it's quite interesting. Before we had a break, I said nobody could ever be disqualified from driving. When I got into the Freeman early stuff, I don't know why I said that, I'm cracking up. When I went to this early Freeman stuff, it were scared of the name, learnt about legalese. I got stopped like cops. What did they say? Why are you driving with no tax? And it were, I'm not driving, I'm travelling. This is all I knew at the time, 4 or 5 years ago. So these key words, the legalese, law, language of the law that we don't understand. I learnt it early on and thought, right, I'm not driving. Driving means you're engaging in commerce, you're getting paid for it. So I'd say that cop at the road, I'm not driving. He said, what are you doing now? I said, I'm travelling. Free right to travel. I had somebody in the car with me. He said, well, who's your passenger? If you have a passenger, what's a passenger? They pay a fee to travel, as in a train or a bus. I'd say, that's not my passenger, that's my guest. And I didn't really win. And when I look back now, I think, Well, we're a bit of a knobhead, really. No wonder he didn't understand it, because it's bollocks, it doesn't make any difference. What I say to him now is, I don't care what words in court, cops or out, use the word driving. Driving means you're engaging in common. I don't care. It's what my interpretation of that word is. It's what my intention of that word is. Use your legalese. I don't care about your legalese. It don't apply to me. I'm a sentient human being. I choose my words. If I want to say I'm driving, then I'm fucking driving. If I've got a passenger, I can fill it full of passengers. Do you know what I mean? So what I'm trying to get at is the off tripped us up and the off tripped us with these legalese words. But I use my words. And you disprove that I can't have my own intentions on the same word. It's my word. Does that make sense? What I'm coming from is, I don't care what they're doing anymore. I'm doing what I'm doing. I'm not causing any harm. You prove to me that I can't do whatever I want to do if I'm not causing harm, okay? Sound like a priest preaching, isn't it? I didn't mean to. So, they're trying to get me for, among other things, driving with no insurance. It's a lie, we're on a trader's policy, so that falls down. A bald tyre, well, I'll give them that one. I didn't realise, but yeah, it was a bit under tread. So, not giving me details when I got pulled. No requirement to even speak to them or giving me details. Number one thing, driving whilst disqualified. So, I can't spell it, so I'll put disqual. Okay, thought about it. Carries a 6 months prison sentence, believe it or not. I sent my licence back years ago. I don't want a licence. What do I want a licence for? What's a licence? It's permission. All right, then. Thought about it. Hang on a minute. I've got Universal Declaration of Human Rights there. Not the Human Rights Act, that's a statute again. Universal Declaration of Human Rights. God gave me freedom to travel planet Earth. Nobody, according to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, nobody can interfere with your free right to travel. Okay. In order to be able to travel, I decide to drive a car. Well, I need a license. Well, hang on a minute, what's a license? Well, it's permission, it's a permit. Hang on a minute. Government can only give you permission, can only grant you permission to do lawful things. They can't grant you permission to do something unlawful. They can't grant me permission to burgle someone's house or shoot someone, can they? So hang on a minute. If they can only grant me permission for lawful things, why am I seeking permission anyway? If it's lawful, I don't need permission, do I? I can just go ahead and do it, I'm not hurting anyone. I sent my license back about 5 years ago, I think it was now. So I travel about, but I insure my car. I don't have to, but I want to, because if I run into someone, I'm trying to come from a point of honour. And it's not fair if I smash somebody else's car up, it's my fault. Well, I'll pay for your damages through my insurance, but you don't have to be insured, but I would rather be insured. So the point I'm trying to get is TV license, fishing license, gun license, permit this, certificate that, it's all permission. Why are we seeking permission to do lawful things? You don't have to. They can't make you consent into it. So, driving whilst disqualified is what they're going to get me on. It's gone on now since April, it's gone on for nearly 6 months now. I've adjourned it, I've done this, I've done that, I've used trust, and they've circumvented it and just arrested me as if I've not showed up. I got locked up for 3 days last time. In the end, it's gone on, it's 2 weeks short of 6 months. It got adjourned. I'm in court next week, October the 9th. What I found out is if they don't convict me within 6 months or anybody of a statutory offence, it goes away. You've got 6 months. Not a criminal offence, a statutory offence. They've sneakily stubbed it in for October 9th after an adjournment. I'm 2 weeks short. If I can get it adjourned, it's done with. But I don't think they're going to adjourn it. So I've come up with an even better plan. So what I'm going to do is, I don't want to announce it now, but you'll either know next Tuesday, I do my radio show, criticalmassradio.co.uk. My show is Out of the Matrix. Next Wednesday I'll be doing the show. I'll either be locked up on Tuesday and you'll not see me for 6 months, or I'll be doing my show Wednesday. If I do my show Wednesday and I'm there, try and tune into it, because I'm going to tell you what's really happened. I've found a way. I'm 99% sure, and I can't divulge it now because it might not work. If it does work, and I'm really sure it's going to, I found a way that we can never, ever, ever be subject to any statute again. No court order, no judgment, no nothing. We've not committed a crime. We can never ever be took to court in a statute court and be held accountable by a corporation. Now, if it works, and I know it's going to, I'm going to divulge that on Wednesday and I'll come back and speak to you about it. So if you tune in on Wednesday at 7 o'clock and I'm not there, then you know it's not worked. Come and bake me a cake or something like that. Right, so
filing.
Tell me, hey?
You've disappeared somewhere.
But if it doesn't work, it's only not work on for two reasons. One, I've not quite tweaked it, which I know I've spent so much time. I had 3 hours sleep last night and three the night before getting the papers into court. The only way it won't work is that they think, fuck you. And they do something unlawful, and unlawfully incarcerate me. That's the only thing they can do now. They can't do anything. All they can do is kidnap me and take me away and shut me up.
They will do it in the interests of the nation.
Yeah, well, they see them as a terrorist or something. But, I can't get onto it now, but I am then taking them to a higher court, which that's one about, called the Queen's Bench Division, which means that all the public servants, cops, magistrates, and all the lot, I'm taking it to a higher court myself, cost me 35 quid to take them, that's all it is. And now they've got to provide all the evidence and justify their previous actions. So even if they do get me locked up, I'll do my time, 6 months, I'll do 3 months, and I don't know what's going on because I'm a single parent, so, but I'm not bothered, I'll sort it. Then I can take them to a higher court for what's called punitive damages, which means not just damages in money, it's a punishment to them. So I've already informed them that if they don't decease, stop basically what they're doing, that I will be taking them to a higher court and I'm ready to file them papers now. But that's just an aside. Okay, because the magistrates and judges in my town absolutely hate me, they said last time after they kidnapped me that if I don't plead, because I won't plead, they can't move forward if you don't plead, they said they will give me the maximum they can if I don't plead. Basically if I don't plead to the charges. And because I won't, they're going to try and give me 6 months, which is the maximum they can give me. So, what have they got me on? The only insurance is an order bollocks, because you don't get done anyway. Bolt ties are points on your licence, which I've not got anyway. And not yet. Well, I haven't even got one. You could lose your licence. I said, good, yeah. So I sent it back 5 years ago. Oh, yeah. I don't even know what it looks like. I didn't even have a photo on it. Another one were, what were it? Not giving me details. That's a lot of rubbish anyway, you don't have to. So they've got one charge against me. I'll admit, tie, I think, because I'm trying to be honourable. It was under tread, I didn't know the time, yeah, but so what? Just give me a slam, that's it, I'll cope with that. So the big one is disqualification, 6 months. So, studied it. How long ago? Not long ago. Figured out, right. I thought, right, I'll use your law books, your law dictionaries, right, what is disqualification? Okay. Disqualification is Black's Law Dictionary, 9th edition, one at latest, I think 10 to come out now, but one at latest. Disqualification or to be disqualified means ineligible. It means ineligible. I always get this wrong. Okay, so let's look up ineligible. Their books, their laws, their statutes, not real laws, their language, ineligible. Unable to hold office. What? Okay. Disqualified. Okay. To make ineligible, unable to hold office. They're stopping me being a government agent.
Yeah.
What? They're stopping me working for the government. Well, that's what I fucking want. That's why I've sent my license back to Pillar. You're then proving my point. You can... What's that? Excuse me. Is it on camera?
Yeah.
Hello? Oh, okay, yeah. It's Judge Julie. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Right. Yeah, see it? Right. Yeah. Guilty. Okay.
She always rings me.
She's seen my film, she thinks they're great. I like hers as well. Yeah, so I can't be that was bollocks, haven't it? Can't be disqualified because ineligible to hold office. I cannot. So what they're saying I can't work for the government. So when you have a license or a permit, you're a government employee. Well, I don't want to be that, do I? That's why I've sent it back. So you can never ever be disqualified from driving. Okay.
You're aware of the power of attorney? You're aware of all that, yeah? What you're walking into is power of attorney, yeah? Power of appointment, power of attorney. So you mentioned the words office and
yes.
Powers.
Yeah, but what I try and do, Rob, is stay away from all that. Stay away from...
Unless he's in a trust, though.
He's confusing.
He's in trust.
Is it?
That's what trusts are. So trusts are all about.
Yeah, power of attorney. Yeah, it's like authority, isn't it?
That driving license says your power of attorney to represent the beast.
Your
cargo. Basically.
That was brilliant, yeah. I need to chat because you've got some stuff I've not thought of. I can implement that and spread it like, yeah. So you can never be disqualified, so they can't be disqualified anyway. What did I want to get on? I want to throw me that phone call. So I can't be disqualified, but like I say, I've got this thing together, and Holy Trinity, it's got three parts to it. One part I can't claim credit for, that's by somebody else, I'll not tell you yet. And I've put the other two bits together, including trust. These three things I've sent off, if it works, like I say, none of us ever will be done for a statutory offence again, ever held accountable. And a corporation can never take us to court and get any joy. It'll stop it every single time. And if I do it right, it'll stop it before any court hearing. There is no argument. I've explained to my brother, he understands it. It's pretty feasible, isn't it, mate?
Million.
As a percentage, what would you say? From what you know, it's up there, isn't it?
100.
It's over 95%.
It's well up there, yeah.
And if it's right, we're all going to do it. Because there is all that other stuff, but it's so complicated, isn't it? And you've got to spend thousands of hours to just get a little bit. You know what you're saying, Rob? The amount of studying you've got to do just to find that power attorney bit, isn't it? You can't, nobody tells you, do they? You've got to figure it out, and somebody says something, and somebody contradicts it, and before you know it, you're spending hours. This, what I've put together, I'm... If it works, we're all going to be able to do it, and it's simple. And we'll all do it, and we'll sit down with pen and paper till we can all do it. And we can head off any court case. Not a criminal, you deserve what you get. But if you have committed a crime, if you've not committed a crime, you're never held accountable, are you? They can never prove it, but it goes way beyond that. The onus on them, in fact, you ask them a question that if they cannot possibly answer. And if they don't answer it, they've got no standing, and they admit they've got no standing. If they do answer it, they're proving your point that they've got no authority whatsoever over you. They cannot win. They can't even ignore it. They can't do anything. I got a scared letter back. I don't want to go into it, but I gave CPS 7 days, Crown Prosecution Service, my trustees. I gave them 7 days to answer me one simple question. The letter I got, all the way through these 6 months, it's been CPS versus Rob Freeman for the driving whilst disqualified. They've sent it me all the time. I've appeared in court, I've adjourned it. CPS v. Rob Freeman every time. I give them 7 days. On the very day the deadline was up, they've not answered back, agreeing with me by consent. I get a letter from my magistrate's court saying, this is just to remind you, you've got a court hearing next week. Are you still representing yourself? Are you pleading guilty or not guilty? Do you need a really friendly letter? Just from the magistrate's court, it said, it didn't say Crown Prosecution Service or the Crown v. Rob Freeman. All it said were, in little writing, not even capitals, police v. yourself. Not even the police. What I've proved is that the Crown has got no authority to even take you to court in the first place. Whether the Crown is Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth or the Crown Corporation, I don't know if you're aware of it, none of them have got a right to even take you to court. And so I'm hoping they're going to just forget it. And if they don't, I can still prove it in court. But I'm not going to go into that, but now it's a scared letter. It's the first time ever they've not put the Crown v. Rob Freeman. I've never known to get a court letter saying, please v. yourself. You know, it's usually a named party, isn't it?
Yeah.
Not even the police. It could be our police, it could be Love Police for all I know. It could be anything, couldn't it? Probably in my case, fashion police. Anyway, couldn't it? So anyway, I don't want to go into great detail on that. So you can never be disqualified. They can prevent you from holding office and being a government employee, which is what your national insurance number is all about. I don't want to be a government. I've sent it back. Have I got a passport? I've got a passport, it's not run out, but that's going back soon. I found out you can travel on a live birth record and a Bible. I'm not sure how to do it yet. You may have heard of this yourselves. passport, it's back to Admiralty Maritime, you're passing the port, aren't you? You get searched at airports, you've got no rights, have you? It's your corporate fiction, your legal fiction name that's got no rights. As a human being, we've got rights, haven't we? It'll not take me long. Live birth record as opposed to a birth certificate. I want to get that in place. And a Bible. Say I'm going to Spain. I ring up Spain and I say, look, me and my family are travelling on a live birth record and a Bible. It's our religion. Are we all right to come in? And they'll say, most countries will say yes. And then you don't need a passport. Which means you're not subject to their corporate rules inside that airport. It's a port again, isn't it? So that's something for the future I'll be working off when this court case goes. Okay, so that's disqualification. I'll expand on that next time. You can never be done. Unless I do next week, then everything I've said is bollocks. No, they can only do it unlawfully. So, I'm just going to tell you what court is. I mentioned this on the show last week. Summary, is it convictions, you sometimes call it. Council tax, everything else. Summary judgment, isn't it? Summary judgment.
Yeah.
Okay, I've always said, statute court, civil court, whatever you want to call it, they call it summary judgment, don't they? Then you get a summary conviction. Summary means they've already made the mind up you're guilty before you go in. 97% of the time they win. Or the judge sides with the corporation and we lose. They give us 3% to keep that illusion of justice going, don't they? Summary judgments. Summary, they've made the mind up before you go in. Or you get summary convictions. So I sort of think, hang on a minute, how long has this been going on then? They're supposed to adjudicate impartially, aren't they, but they side with the corporations, but they've already made the mind up that you're guilty before you go in. That's why it's summary. Hang on a minute, how have they managed to get away with it? And what I've realised is, from about 200 years ago, is summary judgment, summary court, summary convictions, whatever you want to call it, its real title a couple hundred years ago was, it's going to take me ages to write it out, and I hope it's not boring, summary, I've got to write it out so we can break it down. I don't know if you know about this, I don't think many people come across this, okay, I'm rubbish at spelling, but, oh man, it's going to last forever this. So good job, Alex is brilliant at editing. I've grown a beard here. You know. I don't know if anybody can read that, so I'll read it out. Originally, it was called, a couple hundred years ago, Summary Execution of Mercantile Instruments. Right, God for, isn't it? This is what I do in my spare time, it's not that I've got any. This is how boring I am. So I found out 200 years ago it was called Summary Execution of Mercantile Instruments. I ain't got many talents, but I'm good at breaking things down, so let's break it down, so I did. This is what summary conviction, summary judgment is in magistrates court and county court, not criminal court. It's a summary execution of mercantile instruments. Okay, mercantile. I've made a few notes. I'm tired. Mercantile means of or relating to merchants or trading, which equals commerce. It's called the mercantile system. So now we know that's what that is. That's what it was originally called. So mercantile is commerce. So you are being judged money by money, aren't you? That's why you get fined. So we know it's not a court of law now. We know there's no justice because it's money. Remember I said the counting? So it backs it up. Okay. I'll read it off here. Okay, so we know it's mercantile. We know it's business. Just give me a sec. Okay, so what they're doing is they're executing what they call debt instruments. It's called a debt instrument. The reason they're doing it summarily, before you go in, it's what reason I'm getting this out is it's proving what's happening in magistrates' court. It's why we can't win. As well as all the satanic, bloody ritual, priesthood, church bollocks as well, and the trust stuff, it's also this. So how many things are going off? They are summarily executing debt instruments. So, council tax people take the court, summary judgment, you get found guilty. They have already agreed that there's a debt instrument outstanding in my name. Remember when I said they throw that fishing line out? Not only am I a sinner before I go in, I'm a debtor before I go in. And this is how they've done it. So we are being judged, not by law, not by justice, not by fairness of law, not by our actions, we're being judged by, they are summarily executing debt instruments against us. Problem is that these debt instruments don't exist. See if I can explain it a little bit better. Okay. Because there's no contracts ever in place, what they're saying, they're presuming that council tax, for instance, have got a contract with us. Now, we've proved that they haven't. So they're bypassing the whole thing about contracts. All they're really doing is siding with the corporation that we are automatically in debt. They're not judging us as human beings. They are beings. They are judging that there is a debt instrument against the legal fiction name. So whether we turn up, they say, well, they say if we don't turn up, we'll do it in your absence. They're not judging the human being's actions. That's why there is no law, there is no justice. What they are judging is the legal fiction name, as they call it, the corporate name, has got a debt instrument attached to it from an implied contract that doesn't exist. So you can stand up and argue about the legality or the lawfulness of council tax all day long, and you're just going to lose every time. So another way that the AMRA is basically. Now you think, what I've spoken about, it's a lot to take in, isn't it? All those things are happening all at once in court. They're going out and coming back on the recesses, the trust stuff, which I'll go into another time, the sacred law things happening, that they are priests and we are original sinners. All that is happening. How the hell can we ever, and I know we do win some court cases, but what chance have we got? Now, it all sounds too much, doesn't it, and what can we do about it? What we can do about it is, if this works, what I'm saying, knowing all this, sometimes a really complicated question could go on forever, but sometimes the answer is really simple. And if I've got it right, the answer is really simple. Because what you've got to do is you've got to clean all the shit away, blow all the dust away, wipe it down, and it's there in front of you. It's just that we've been focused on that many distractions, we've not realised it's there all the time. And it comes back to one thing, is have we done anything wrong? And we haven't. So in what way are we able to be held accountable or punished? We're not, are we? Because we've not hurt anybody. And my system of any financial demand is, well, all right, I might owe it. You just chuck us a bit of proof that I owe it and I'll pay it. So we're doing nothing wrong. We're staying honourable all the time. These are acting in dishonour. They're starting to panic a bit now because we're starting to get some results. So I just want to tell you that. Basically, it's your legal fiction name has got a debt instrument held against it. Okay, so I did this ages ago and I keep doing it and they leave me alone now. So he makes a judgment in court and he makes, what is it? An order, doesn't he? I don't know if anybody else besides me had loads of orders. I love them, me. I charge a fortune for my orders. Okay, so early Freeman stuff, I got this, one of the very first things I learned. excuse me, judges and magistrates have ordered against me. Sort of thinking, hang on a minute. Nobody can tell me what to do on this planet, and he's ordering me, and a cop, he might order me. A judge has made an order, so I thought, well, legally speaking, using their system, what's an order? Okay. If you go into McDonald's, you don't ever want to eat at McDonald's, do you? But say you went into McDonald's, you go to the counter, don't you? What's the first thing the lad or lass, that's usually like that, aren't they? They usually say, can I take your order? And you say, oh, go on then, I'll have three Big Macs and four milkshakes because I'm on a diet this week. Yeah? And then they bring it, don't they, in 2 minutes because it's ramel, isn't it? It's just really manufactured shit, isn't it? And they bring it, don't they? And then what happens? They bill you, don't they? I thought, hang on a minute, what's an order? Going back to my mate, Judge Judy, I used to like them programmes. I watched reruns of them. You watch Judge Judy, right? She listens to both sides, makes a determination, and what does she do? Takes you two, not like this. Takes you two, I'm Judge Judy. Oh, is she? And she goes, boom, I award you $3,000. She makes an order, but what does she do? She clears the stuff up. As soon as that hammer comes down, and fucks off straight away. You know why? Every order instantly creates a liability for the person making that order. That's why they cough into the back, because they know it. You walk straight into McDonald's, you place an order, Yeah? You're ordering something, you instantly create a bill. That's why they disappear. So, judges, magistrates have given me orders. Brilliant, sending me every week for all I care. I used to try and fight them at one time, try and get rid of them, and I've done that now. All I do is, I send the order back, or I copy it, and I send my own notice back. Usually an order is to pay something, or to perform a task, or to stop performing a task.
Will that cover liability orders?
Any order, it's an order, isn't it? Who gives orders? Well, how can they give an order? It's to pay or perform a task or to stop doing something, usually, isn't it? Any order. Liability order, they want you to pay, don't they? What are they asking for? They're ordering from my catalogue for me to perform a service. Well, you can do that every day for me. I'll send you my schedule of fees for my order. I'm not forcing you to order from me. You want my service? It's simple. It's simple. You want me to do something? That's why they're disappearing, right? You want me to do something? Lovely. We're very busy at the moment. I'll try and service your order, but for me to appear next week, give me an example of an order. What would be an order? A simple order. Mine's going to be plain.
Stop playing music after 11.
Okay, brilliant. Now. Have you been around my house? I always play music after 11. Okay, I get an order. Can you please stop playing music? But that's causing a little bit of harm to someone. That's
right,
not
well, right. After 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Okay then, stop playing heavy metal, play that music. Okay, so I'm not harming anyone, it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon, so I get an order, a judgment, he's made an order, you must stop playing, which means me, this is my judge's order. That's why they don't like signing them, because they're instantly liable. So I say, yeah, no problem, you wanted me to provide a service, lovely, we're very busy at the moment, I'm going to try and get it in as fast as possible for you. Oh, and by the way, every order creates a liability, so here's my bill. My services, £3,000. Thank you very much. Usually, I want you to pay up front. We are so busy and our clientele are that good, we usually ask for the money up front. But because you know, you seem alright, I'm going to give you 7 days to pay it. So now, what can they do? They've instantly created a liability for a bill, have they not? Now, I'm not asking them to, they don't have to do business. It's all about business, that mercantile shit I'm telling you about. Whether it's a store my name, legal fiction name, whatever, they're ordering something off me that I can provide. And all I'm doing is giving them my bill for my services provided. Now, instead of fighting the order, the way he's smiling now, the flies are done. I said that last time. Yeah. Okay. I thought you were laughing at me. What was I saying? You've got good eyes. You've got a zoom lens on that. I always do that, don't I? Instead of fighting their orders and stuff, accepting again. I'll accept your order, no problem, but this is my bill that you've just created. So what will they do? If I order from one place and it's 100 quid, and I look at another place, it's 500 quid, I'm going to go to the cheapest one, aren't I? So I'm not forcing them to do business with me, mate. It's all about business, isn't it? So send me an order, no problem, whatever it is, boom, there's my bill, I've got 7 days to pay it. So it goes away. I've sent them loads to magistrates and that, sounds crazy, doesn't it? But their ordering, so they're personally liable. Do you see what I'm saying? So that's that bit, so never be scared of a court order, or any order. You can disobey it, it's statute, isn't it? It's there by consent, isn't it? It's an order. And all you've got to get your head around is, everything that is an act, a statute, a bylaw, code, bloody ordinance, whatever, code, this, bollocks, that, it's all by consent and nobody can force you into that consent. It's up to you whether you want consent. So again, just turn it back around again. So that's what I do. So I don't seem to get many orders now. Listen, if you try and lock me up next week, I've already put my bill in for the day. I know. Not over tits up like, but it's worth a go, isn't it? They wanted me to do something that I don't want to do, and that I'm really too busy to do. I've got 2 kids to look after, and, you know, I have to keep this air in place. It takes me hours. So if you want me to do something, don't laugh, it's not that bad. If you want me to do something, well, they want me to go to prison, don't they, for 6 months? Well, it's going to cost you like £2 million, and this is payable up front. Do you know what I mean? You don't have to ask for my services. You know, I can take the business elsewhere. I'm not asking you. So if they want to order from me, then they're liable for the bill. So that's it, simple as that.
Or they say, oh, we don't read this. Letters,
well,
the, you know,
well, so far
from this Freeman, wherever.
Well, so far, no one's ever taken me to court for money for any demand for money, which I don't know anybody who's never been to court for money. And I've only been locked up by the police at the side of the road, either overnight or for 2 or 3 days. But I've never been locked up. I've never been convicted in a court. All they can really do is do something unlawful and kidnap me and try and drag me in there to get me to consent. Remember, it's not criminal, it's just statute. Mm-hmm. And so far, they've got all this power and no one's ever been able to do it yet, so I must be doing something right, eh? Mm-hmm. But trying to enforce money off somebody else is a very difficult thing to do. And taking the goods off them is not going to get you your money, is it? So it is very difficult, to be honest. So if I'm still here next week, then we can all do it, and it's simple. And like I say, I've really simplified it, but when you look at it, it's not. This whole legal system, this whole thing, is shrouded in complications and confusion. When you dust it away, like I said, the answer's really simple. The reason it's simple is statutes have got the force of law by your consent. Now, whether they trick you into that consent, you can revoke that consent at any time, and that's what I do. And that's what they don't like. So they cannot force you. It's that free will thing. You're supposed to have free will. I think we still have just. Well, like I said on that talk last time, if we don't start doing things, I don't know if you agree, Alex, and you, Paul, but I think we've got a window of opportunity for about 18 months, maybe 2 years at a push, but if we don't start doing something, they're just going to railroad straight over us, and there's not enough of us. We sat here, we could all be doing something better, couldn't we, but we all want to be here, and we're all feeling better for it. I know I am from talking to you and saying last time. It actually helps me when I speak to you. We've got these sleeping masses, really, that don't know anything, do they? These people, everything's voluntary. These people that are running things have got what's called, they call it plausible deniability. And what they're saying is, in their sick psycho minds, the 4% psychos that are running things, is they're not doing anything wrong in their minds. And the reason they're not doing anything wrong is everything's voluntary, everything's by consent, and we're acquiescing to it, we're being apathetical, if that's such a word. And all we've got to do is revoke consent. Most important word in the English language, no. It's a two-letter word. Just say no. And that's all I do, I just say no. Second most important word is trust.
Can you say you're going to accept something, though?
Sorry?
You're going to accept something, you accept their offer, then isn't that wrong?
You accept it on condition. Oh, sorry, I didn't make myself clear. It's called conditional acceptance.
Yeah, well, that's contracting.
You're avoiding controversy doing that. Yeah.
Yes.
By saying,
conditional, you're accepting it. You're accepting it, but on condition that they prove that they give you 2 or 3 things, and then, so there's no controversy, like Rob says, there's no conflict, there's no reason to go to court, because you're not fighting, you're not arguing. Not disputing, yep, I might owe that, or yep, judge, 6 months prison, yep, no problem, yeah, if that's what you want to do, okay, there's £1 million bill, please, I want it paid now, can I have a cheque, please, I'll do 6 months for £1 million, I'm not bothered, we'll spread it out with us, what we're all going on with, I'm not bothered. So, I'm accepting on, but I'm accepting on condition, on that you've got a valid claim against me, which CPS haven't, if it's a financial demand, prove that I owe it you. There's so many arguments, it's not just one thing. For instance, if there's no injured party, like I said before, prove you've got a valid claim. I'm accepting it, okay, you might say I'm under some obligation, but prove it, who's been hurt, who's the injured party, who's making the complaint, why isn't there a life signature on the complaint? You know, if I do something to you and you got it pleased, you sign a witness statement with a life signature, don't they? And you're willing to stand up in court and say, he come up and smack me, aren't you? But they don't, do they? There's no pen to paper. So it's as simple as that. Who's bringing the claim against me? What are you saying I can or can't do? Or what are you saying I have done? Then put your signature. I want to talk about signature, we're running out of time. Most important thing you'll ever use is your own signature on a piece of paper. Somebody's taking me to court, put your signature live on that piece of paper, and say that I have done or whatever, because whoever puts the writing on a piece of paper assumes all liability if it goes tits up, and that's why they will never do it. You'll get a squiggle or a photocopied squiggle, and you probably those names don't even exist for those corporations. They make them up, don't they? So it's about assuming liability. They want us to assume all the liability, excuse me, with our signature, whilst they shove liability to one side with no signature. Your signature is everything. So be selective of where you put your signature from now on. In fact, I'll do this next time. I might even do it on my show. I keep threatening to do it. Be really selective where you put... Nobody on this planet can make you put pen to paper. When I get arrested by the police, which is usually about every 3 months it crops up, when I get out, I do not sign. I won't put pen to paper. I won't accept the paperwork. Nobody can force me to. Without your signature, they've got nothing. I've got two police interview tapes relating to this. And all it is a copper talking to himself. I don't say anything. I don't say nothing. They're really boring, but they're a good laugh. Because I don't speak at all. There's no name. There's no comment. There's nothing. He might as well be sat talking to himself. Now, how the hell is he going to enforce that in court? I've got the copy because they give you the copy. I don't sign for anything. I don't give them a name. As soon as I know I'm under arrest, I exercise my rights to shut up, and I do. And I sit there for 3 days, 2 days, whatever it is, and I don't say a word. They keep saying, oh, Rob, or Mr. Freeman, or whatever, and I'm in my cell. They'll come to me, and I'll go, me? Like, I look round, I'm in my cell, my home. Oh, you talking to me? And so I won't even contract, not that I'm bothered about the name, but I won't even contract. I will not even speak to him if I can help it, other than maybe if you say you want a cup of tea, but I don't even eat and drink. But if I'm in a long time, I start to feel a bit weak, so then I accept a cup of coffee. I think they're going to put something in it, or I don't trust them on it. But they get nothing off me, and they try and bully you at the interview. I don't know if anyone's been interviewed in the police station. They try and be intimidating, don't they? And what's odd is I'm sat around a table like this, and they're asking you questions that they already know answer to. And I did this on my show. 99% of all police convictions for anything is you confessing, basically, tripping yourself up with your words. Now, he's just told me I've got the right to remain silent. Anything that I say, he's going to be used against me. So why the hell would I even speak from that point on? You wouldn't, would you? You'd be stupid to, but we all do, don't we? You feel an obligation to talk. So I don't speak to them at all, because anything that comes out of your mouth, they're going to use against you. If nothing comes out of your mouth, what have they got? They've got two blank tapes with a copper talking, but I don't even make eye contact. It's two of them. If you're interviewing me and you ask me a question, if I look at you, they can say, Rob Freeman just nodded. And then I'll say, no, fucking, oh. So I look at the table, and all you can hear is, Mr. Freeman was staring at the table. Mr. Freeman scratched his head. Mr. Freeman looks like he's asleep. And that's all they kept saying in the thing, because it's a hard thing to do for like 45 minutes, and they try and trip you up, but just don't incriminate yourself, basically. I don't know why we're going, why did we get onto that?
Practice on your missus. Should be good at that.
Say again.
Say, practice on your missus.
I ain't got one.
Practicing.
She left 5 years ago, so that's probably why. Okay, so to answer that again, it's conditional acceptance. Accept it, but on condition.
We've got a quick thing they're not sure about what we spoke about. Nothing specific like their own case, because it'll go on forever and we'll all be like this.
Has anybody got a question about anything that I've mentioned on here?
National insurance, Rob. Yeah, you mentioned national insurance, and I was self-employed for a bit. And when they sent you a bill for national insurance, he said that if you do not pay, it may affect your pension. But look at about you have to pay national insurance.
Okay. So your national insurance?
Totally voluntary. Yeah, it's voluntary.
It is voluntary, yeah.
So by actually paying it, you're putting yourself in a frame, aren't you?
You are, yeah. And it's back to that national insurance is evidence of something, isn't it? In America, it came from America, it's called social insurance. In fact, I meant to bring it tonight. A chap called Edward Mandel House, who helped create this social insurance, they call it over there. I've tried to trawl documents, original British documents, to national insurance. In America, it's called social insurance. I can't find one, it relates back to America. They did it in America first. I meant to bring it tonight to read it out, the plan they've done. I'll do it next time. That's how they've created the... That's how they've created the corporate entity for enslavement, but you're right. I
ask you a question. If you've got national insurance, why would you need any other kind of insurance? Why do you need car insurance, house insurance? Why? Because it's national. It should cover everything, shouldn't it?
It changed in 1954.
Was it 54?
National insurance covered all drivers until 1954.
It covered drivers, did it? Oh, right, I didn't know that. That's interesting.
If you get in touch with the IRS, give them your national insurance number here, they will give you your American EIN.
Yeah, so national insurance is voluntary.
By opting out of it, though, that might be too far if we all opted out of national insurance.
Yeah, so there's a lot of... Like I say, we've got to take revenue back off them, haven't we? And this is what I just want to close up on now. All these things are connected, and like national insurance, if we all could opt out of national insurance and income tax with our employers, if we get them aboard and start looking at private contracts, I think everybody under 16 right now is not going to see a pension.
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody, do you agree?
Yeah.
It's a big scam. It's
a Ponzi scheme.
It is. You're born, you get a birth certificate shortly after. CV, you send a CV off for a job, all it is you're giving a commercial value. You got a birth certificate, you work, you get national insurance, you start work, it's all pay, get as much tax off you as possible, you have a commercial value all the way through your life, they treat you with national insurance and pension this and investment that, it's all a load of bollocks. The whole game is a game of monopoly, it's to extract as much off you, make you work like a worker and like a dog all your life, and the trick is to extract everything off you, give the illusion of... You own your house, you own property, you register it all, you own fuck all. The provision is to take it all back off you. The idea is to make us work like slaves all our lives, and at the end of it, have nothing left. If we try and pass it on to our kids, they might be able to for a short while, but they'll get it nicked back off them. And it's all about stealing everything off us and treating us like slaves. And we've deserved it up to this last few, now we don't deserve it. So what we do is, we stop paying national insurance, we start looking at stuff like this. The only way I can think of, and I'm going to close up now, the only way I can think of is to hurt them, the powers that were, I call them, because whoever wins or loses, it doesn't matter, we're going to give it a good try, is to take back, stop feeding them the money. If it's one pence, if it's one pence away from them, I'm happy. If it's £1 million, I'm even happier. We all should be thinking of ways of trying not to feed them this cash. Because that's, we're all enslaved, religion, words, everything, legalese. The number one thing that enslaves us all is money, because we can't even feed ourselves without it. We spend all this time getting it, and we can't keep hold of it, can we, because it's extracted off us. So the biggest enslavement of it all, I've about done, is money. Next time, if we could try and find out what money actually is that we don't pay for anything, so let's keep as much as we can for ourselves like they do and stop giving it them. And if enough of us can do it and get together, then it will collapse. So stop feeding the bastards. And let's all keep grouping together. We're the right, we're in the right, they're in the wrong. The only way we're going to have any success is stop fucking paying them. Okay? So thanks a lot for listening.